While the Brewers fans prepared their feast outside County Stadium yesterday, the Cubs offense was feasting on Milwaukee's pitching inside, hitting four home runs, staking the Cubs to a big lead, and leaving the Brew Crew to play catch-up, which they almost did, thanks to the bat of Jeremy Burnett. The big right fielder's heroics, however, were too little and too late. Today, Steve Traxel tries again for his first win, while the Brewers look to fish out their first home win of 1999. Game two from a chilly Milwaukee is next on WGN. Cool, cloudy day today in Milwaukee, but still a big crowd expected for today's game two of a three-game weekend series between the Chicago Cubs and the Milwaukee Brewers from County Stadium. We'll have every pitch, every play for you today here on WGN Sports. Hi again, everybody. Along with Steve Stone, I'm Chip Caray. Welcome to Cubs baseball, and welcome back to life, the Cubs offense. And it seems every time we play this Milwaukee team, Steve, the Cubs hitters start hitting. Now we need a little more pitching, too.
Last year, the Cubs just killed the Brewers, and yesterday was no exception. They carried it over. Take a look at what they did the first eight games and yesterday, and this Brewer pitching staff is beleaguered. In fact, they had a meeting about the pitching or the lack of it, and the whole front office was there. I'm not sure what they're going to do, but Rafael Roque is going to have the good one today against Steve Traxel.
Yeah, Steve's looking for his first win of the year, Stoney, and he hasn't pitched like Steve Traxel pitched last season. We need to get him going with a big ball game today.
This is a good offensive team here in Milwaukee. Pitching is a problem, so the Cub hitters should be in good shape. Hopefully Traxel will turn it around.
Again, a cool and cloudy day, no rain forecast. That's good news. Hopefully the Cubs can win their third game in a row. It's the Cubs and Brewers starting lineups coming away right after this.
Chicago Cubs baseball on WGN is brought to you by
Mosa's second blast of the year.
The Cubs are facing the right staff at the right time. This Milwaukee pitching staff has an ERA of 6.56. The starters have an ERA of 7.45. And so Roque, who's been battered around in two starts, trying to turn it around. And you'd have to think that the Cub hitters, who just murdered this team yesterday and most of last season, we'll see more of the same today.
And the weather forecasters have let us down a little bit. There is a light drizzle starting to fall here at the ballpark, so hopefully it won't get any heavier. As we look out toward left field, the skies are a little bit lighter, and the wind is blowing from left field to right field, so hopefully the bad weather will stay away and we can get this game in unimpeded here on a chilly Saturday in Milwaukee. The Cubs have won their last two games in a row. And they go for number three today for that man, Jim Riggleman. And here's his lineup. He shuffles it up a little bit. Lance Johnson gets the day off today. Manny Alexander is going to get the start today at the shortstop position. It'll be his first start of the year for the Cubs. Jeff Blauser still working on that elbow. Riggs told me before the game that Jeff probably not ready to play shortstop yet. He could see some action tomorrow, perhaps, at the second base position for the Cubs.
Roque is a soft-tossing left-hander, and he's had problems with his control. He's the kind of a guy that has to have perfect control to be successful. The first time around last year, Roque threw some very good ball games. The second time any team saw him, they hit him pretty hard. Got a curveball. He throws about 86, 87 miles an hour. In fact, this entire Brewer staff throws about the same speed. Nobody throws real hard. They're all finesse pitchers.
And the Cubs at times have had trouble with those kinds of finesse pitchers, so they've got to be ready for the off-speed stuff today. Again, here's the Cubs lineup. Manny Alexander gets the start at shortstop. Jose Hernandez gets his first start of the year in center field. Then it's Mark Grace, Sammy Sosa, who has absolutely murdered the Brewers pitching staff. Glenn Allen Hill in left. Benito Santiago, who hit to that triple play yesterday behind the plate. Gary Gaetti at third base. Mickey Morandini hits eighth at second base. And Steve Traxel completes the Cubs' Pepsi starting lineup.
And the defense for Phil Garner and his Brewers, Jenkins, Grissom, and Burnett left to right. Cirillo, Loretta, Vina, and Berry in a very good Brewer infield. Nielsen and Roque make up the battery. And there's a look at Rafael Roque. You see the ERA well up there. This is his third start, and control has been a big factor. And what Phil Garner said, Chip, was that he's got to get innings out of Roque today. He used that bullpen yesterday. They've got 12 pitchers on this staff because they recognize the problem in spring training. But if he doesn't go deep into the game, they're going to have to bring somebody up from the minor leagues to protect his starters the next few games. So Roque could give them a big lift by going into the sixth or seventh inning today.
Well, he's pitched a grand total of seven innings in his first two starts of the year. That's not going to cut it for this Milwaukee ball club. Roque got the opening day start, the first ever Brewer rookie to be an opening day starter in their franchise history. And his first pitch to Manny sails high for ball one.
He's a high fastball pitcher, and more times than not, when he's wild high and away to the right-hand hitter.
A chilly day, 44 degrees at game time, winds out of the northeast at 12 miles per hour.
Roque has walked 8 in 7 innings, and that kind of control gets you a lot of losses and a lot of runs given up.
2-0 to Manny, and he makes him throw a strike. 2 balls and a strike. Congratulations to the Bears and Cade McNown, the quarterback from UCLA, the Bears' first-round draft pick in the NFL draft, which is ongoing today. And that ball popped out of play, 2-2.
And the coach got his man. He traded every one of his draft choices and a 1 and a 3 for next year for Ricky Williams. So he talked to us when he conducted the 7th inning stretch on opening day. He said, this is what I want to do. And amazingly enough, it fell to the coach to get him.
And in case you missed the draft coverage, it's safe to say that Mike Ditka's singing of other songs is just as bad as Take Me Out to the Ball Game. A high fly ball hit toward right. Burnett's drifted back. Now comes charging in. He puts it away for out number one. It's going to take a very, very solidly hit ball to get out of the ballpark today if you hit it to right field. So Alexander flies out for out number one.
The wind comes in from left field between Miller Park and the stands and blows straight in from that direction. It didn't affect the ball too much yesterday. It appears, being a little colder today and the wind maybe a little bit harder than yesterday, that it will hold the ball up in left field also.
So center fielder Jose Hernandez stands in. Jose went 1 for 5 yesterday, and he pops that ball foul and out of play. A little wishful thinking for Jose in the clubhouse before the game today. Had one of those mini Wheaties boxes with his bubblegum card taped to the front. He said, this is the new version of the Wheaties box that's coming out here in 1999 season. If he has the kind of year this year like he did last year, there's a good chance that could happen. And that'll wake you up, backs him off the plate, inside a ball and a strike.
I think one of the things Bill Campbell, the pitching coach of the Brewers, told his guys was you have to pitch inside. Most of his guys throw away a lot. And in order to protect that part of the plate, you have to push the hitters back off the inside of the plate. Otherwise, everybody leans outside, starts driving the ball to right and right center field.
2 balls and a strike. Off speed line down the left field line. That's trouble if it's fair. It is, and it is. Jose rounds first. He's on his way to second. It's a one-out double here in the top of the first. You know, Stoney, it's almost like these Brewers pitchers, because they're not overpowering, they're pitching like a lot of college pitchers pitch, and that is avoiding the bat instead of trying to hit a spot.
Here's a changeup, and normally it's a good pitch, but this time Jose just reaches out, drives it down the line. Good piece of hitting by Jose Hernandez. So the Cubs in business here in the first. And I think, Chip, what happens is you start getting hit, then you start trying to make the perfect pitch on every pitch, and suddenly you fall behind, and now you're in even more trouble.
So a runner at second for Mark Grace. Just shows you how funny this game is. Mark Grace hit the ball right on the button every time up yesterday and had just one hit to show for it in 5 trips. And he got a real chuckle out of your strategy discussion from the game yesterday.
Well, if you move to 3-1 and then let him hit the ball hard at somebody, sometimes it works, as it did yesterday.
The 1-0 to Mark Grace with Jose a big lead at second. The left-hander fires. It's lined into center field. Base hit. Grissom comes charging. He has no play on Hernandez, who had to hold up to make sure the ball wasn't caught. And Mark Grace puts runners at first and third. One out for Sammy Sosa.
This just might turn into Phil Garner's worst nightmare. Roque getting pounded early in the game and having to go that bullpen once again. Jose Hernandez had to hold up. He didn't know if Loretta was going to make the play or not. So good base running on the part of Hernandez, who doesn't want to get doubled and get taken out of the inning. Runners at the corners for Sammy, who came alive yesterday.
He's been the hottest of the hot. In fact, he's been on base 8 straight plate appearances for the Cubs. He scored 5 runs during that span. He was 4 for 4 yesterday with a home run and RBI, and he scored 3 times. And what has to encourage him most about Sammy is he's hitting the ball to right field now. And you know the fangs are out against Roque, who served up number 64 to him last year. The runners lead. The first pitch is off speed for a strike, says Tom Hallion.
Not only 64 to Sammy, but amazingly 64 to Mark McGuire. Why does he change his number to 64?
It would have been a marketer's dream.
You've got to be remembered for something.
I thought Traxel ought to change his to 62 for a day, but I don't think Steve would have enjoyed that quite as much. No balls and a strike to Sammy. The runners lead. The pitch misses inside. A stock market type day for Sammy Sosa yesterday. Gained 102 points on his batting average with a 4-for-4 afternoon.
And he did it by going to right field. Had a couple of base hits that way. Sammy will most likely pull Roquet if he gets something off speed.
A 1-1 pitch. Grace leads from first. Swing and a miss. It's 1-2, and here is the flashback from last year, number 64.
And that went to right field on a much sunnier day and made it out by just enough. He'll have to put a little more into it today if he's going to take it out that way, however.
Crowd chanting Sammy here at Caddy Stadium. They're at the corners in the first and Roquet. A token move over there sends Grace back a standing.
That was not his best move. The one thing that Rafael Roquet does have and does very well is a good move to first base. You don't figure Mark Grace to be too adventuresome, but Cubs have to watch that.
The rain has stopped for the moment as the runners lead. Now the 1-2 to Sammy. He didn't chase the high fastball. Count evens now 2-2. The Cubs have played the Brewers 13 times in this National League matchup. The Cubs have scored 99 runs and have hit 34 home runs in 13 games. They're bidding to score run number 100 in the series here in the first. The 2-2. Line foul into the seats. Look out, folks. And a battle for the souvenir.
Yesterday, Phil Garner used six pitchers. And he realizes that you cannot press your bullpen like that on a daily basis. So he has to find some way to get his starting pitching deeper into the game.
I'm sorry, Steve. You mentioned in the open that they had a meeting for about an hour after the ballgame trying to find a way to get some more pitching. Do they have any in the minor leagues, number one? And number two, they obviously can't get here in time for today's game, but this is going to be an ongoing problem for them all year.
There's Sammy yesterday. One of the things that Phil Garner told to both Sal Bando and Cecil Cooper when they met about the pitching staff was get those guys at AAA ready to come up here because we might need them. I mean, you're carrying 12 pitchers already.
But they have huge pitching problems on this team. It goes without saying. And it's only the first week and a half of the year. The 2-2. Sammy with a new bat takes strike three, caught in the inside corner, and he didn't like it. Two down here in the first.
And there's a little example of Roquet trying to protect his outside pitching with an inside fastball, and he caught Sammy looking. Sammy thought it was inside. And you see how Nielsen caught it. He catches it with the glove up, trying to make it look a little bit higher than it was.
Yeah, he might have stolen a strike there. So Sosa's caught looking, and Glenn Allen Hill bats with two on and two out. Glenn Allen had a hit yesterday. Walked three times and scored twice. He's hitting a hefty .550 with four homers and 11 runs batted in. Two out of six lifetime against Roquet. The runners lead the pitch. Off speed line drive right field. Burnett's coming on. Still coming. Can't get there. It drops for a hit. One run scores. Grace tries for third. He'll slide in safely. The ball ricochets off the camera well. And that's a bad break. If it goes in, the Cubs get another run. But still, Hill with another clutch hit. A two-out single to right puts the Cubs in front by a run.
That's 12 runs batted in for Glenn Allen Hill. He drops this one in front of Burnett. Just off the end of the bat. Once again, another changeup. Once again, another base hit. And Burnett, thinking he's got a shot at Mark Grace, throws it by everybody. But unfortunately, this one deflects back into the field of play. Runners still at the corners, but the Cubs have the lead.
For Benito Santiago, who hit a long three-run homer yesterday. We won't mention the other thing he did because that's not so much fun. He also hit to a triple play. 1-0, 3 Cub hits here in the top of the first against this struggling Milwaukee starting staff. Their pitchers this year have allowed 17 home runs. Their team ERA is well over 6. And they all throw, as Steve mentioned, about the same speed. Not a whole lot of hard throwers down there. Again, to first, and Hill is back at first.
Well, the last thing you want to do is get picked off in this situation. You've got a struggling pitcher, not only struggling with his control, struggling with everything about the game. And so you don't want to let him off the hook by falling into what he does best, and that's the pickoff move.
The 1-0 is outside. 2 balls, no strikes. If you wondered about that triple play yesterday, the Cubs had a sign miscommunication. And Benito, I think, was supposed to have been bunting, but there was a mix-up in the signs. He was swinging away, and he bounced into a tailor-made around-the-horn 5-4-3 triple play. The 2-0. Swing and a miss. It's 2-1. And we'll show you that triple play a bit later on in the ballgame.
Roque at 6'4", 190 pounds, out of the Dominican Republic. Now makes his home in Santo Domingo.
A raw day in Milwaukee. The Cubs try to win their third in a row and get back to even money at 5-5 today. Hill leads from first, Grace from third, the 2-1. Is low. 3 balls and a strike with Gary Gaetti on deck.
Here's where you have to watch the move to first. Great hitter's count for Santiago, who looks like he's going to provide some power for the Cubs from behind the plate.
2 homers, 5 ribbies on the year for him. And a hitter's pitch now. 3-1 the count. Here it is. Chased a pitch up in his eyes. 3-2 now. So Hill should be running here with 2 men out. Cubs 1, Brewers yet to bat. Santiago takes his time getting back in there. Glenn Allen measures his lead at first. Here we go, the 3-2. There goes Hill. The pitch swung, lined into center field. Grissom comes on, can't get it. Grace scores. Another 2-out hit. This one by Santiago, and the Cubs have a 2-0 lead. Can we play these guys 162 times?
Well, I'm not sure if the pitchers would enjoy it, but the hitters certainly would. And yet another in a series of trips to the mound for Bill Campbell. As Benito Santiago drives in run number 6, it's a fastball right down the middle. When you're struggling with your control and you're falling behind 3-1, 3-2, you can't use the outside part of the plate unless you have confidence that you have command. He doesn't have the confidence or the command, and the Cubs are taking advantage of it.
So 2 runs, 4 hits here in the first, and Gary Gaetti waiting on deck. He hit a long home run yesterday. That seems to have maybe awakened him a bit. In lifetime against Roque, he's 3-for-5 with a home run. You also remember late in the ballgame, he got hit on the elbow with a pitch. He said it's a little bit swollen, a little bit tender, but obviously he's fit enough to play today. So 2 on, 2 outs. The Cubs with 2 straight, 2-out singles. 1 from Hill, 1 from Santiago. And the pitch from Roque sails outside, 1-0. Eddie hitting 133 on the year with a homer and 3 driven in. In fact, Gaetti closing in on a milestone. He needs just 2 more games after today for the 3rd highest total of games for a third baseman in baseball history.
There's the blast yesterday by Gaetti into the teeth of the wind, and he takes it out of the park.
1 ball, no strikes. That's right through there to even the count at 1-1. Mike Schmidt in third place with 2,212 games. And this is number 2210 for Gaetti. That is a lot of campaigns at the hot corner. 1 ball, 1 strike. Roque has not been okay so far. Off speed, he waited on it and swung late. 1-2. Boy, everybody in the ballpark knew an off-speed pitch was coming there. He really slowed that arm down.
Well, it's not a quick, sharp breaking curveball. It's kind of a big rolling curveball, and it's fairly easy for the right-handers to track. You know, they had one trading piece, Chip, and that was Vigna. And they have failed to get anything back for him. You see, Gary's luck against Roquet has been terrific.
One ball, two strikes. Off speed, pulled to the left side. Knocked down nicely, Cirillos throws to second. He is in time. They got Santiago by an eyelash. And that retires the side. But the Cubs pick up two runs, four hits. Two of the hits coming with two outs and after a half inning. Cubs two, Brewers coming up.
Get on at the top.
Yeah, they're third in the National League in hitting. Are these Milwaukee Brewers? And Fernando Vigna stands in, turned 29 years of age yesterday. And at times like this, you kind of wish they had made that trade with the St. Louis Cardinals to get him out of the uniform of the Brewers. He's a tough, tough cookie in the leadoff spot. And were it not for the Cardinals' pitching problems, Vigna would have probably been playing for them by now.
When Matt Morris went down, it tightened things up in the pitching department for the Cardinals, and they could not give away the pitching talent the Brewers wanted.
Vigna pops it a mile high on the infield. Gary Guidi. In fair territory, battles the wind, and it finally comes down, and Vigna's retired for out number one.
Well, St. Louis needed a second baseman. They were talking about Manny Ibar in return, but Milwaukee was talking about Jose Jimenez, and there was no way they were going to deal him. So those talks kind of fell apart, and of course, they lost Morris for the year. That put even more pressure on the St. Louis pitching staff, pinned it out somewhat. But the Brewers have got to do something, and I'm not sure if anybody in AAA or AA for that matter is ready to come here and start, which is their biggest weakness.
Vigna, a birthday yesterday. Marquise Grissom celebrates number 32 today. And he takes a quick strike from Steve Traxel. One thing you know, the Brewers aren't going to go out and spend a whole lot of money to go get a starting pitcher, and that's probably the priciest commodity that there is a starting pitcher who is successful. So they're in a real, real tough spot.
Next year, things will loosen up somewhat as they think about doubling their payroll in the brand new Miller Park.
A ball and a strike to Grissom, and he's behind 1-2. Wendy Seligpried, the chief officer now of this Milwaukee franchise. Her dad, the commissioner of baseball, Bud Selig, and the Cheeseheads have appeared.
And that qualifies as a hat shot, I guess, technically. It is covering his head. And it is a very cold day for it.
1-2 to Grissom. It's downstairs. Two balls, two strikes. Well, the Cubs staked Scott Sanders to a 6-0 lead yesterday. He couldn't hold it long enough to qualify for the win. Steve Traxel's been given a two-run cushion here after a half inning. And retired a tough leadoff man in Vigna. And he just struck out Marquise Grissom for out number two. Traxel's not messing around much today, is he? Two up, two down.
Well, I think he realizes that you want to keep that bullpen out of there. And he knows he hasn't thrown the ball as well as he can. So here's a fastball, and he threw it right by Grissom. You'd never know it by Roquet in the first, but this very much is a hitter's day. A pitcher's day, rather. It's cold, wind blowing in. You don't want to walk anybody, throw a lot of strikes, let them hit it to your outfielders. They're not going to hit it out in the left too often.
And that's Steve Traxel's game. He's a fly ball pitcher. That should play right into his hands in this big ballpark. So here's Cirillo batting third, playing third for the Brewers. A 238 start for him. No homers, two runs batted in. He went 2-for-5 yesterday. Already he's made a fine defensive play in this ballgame.
What a good effort this is. Cirillo to his left and gets it just ahead of Santiago at second.
No balls and a strike to Cirillo. 0-2. Big key for Traxel, you were talking before the ball game. He's got to have command of that outside corner.
Marty Demerit realizes that. Steve Traxel realizes that. If Traxel controls the outside corner to the right-hand hitters, it sets up the rest of his pitches.
Well, he's got three to play with here against Cirillo. Bouncing ball up the middle. Manny Alexander surrounds that, throws across in time, and tracks it a very easy 1-2-3. Bottom of the first. One inning in the books at County Stadium. Cubs 2, Brewers nothing. Steve Traxel works a 1-2-3 bottom half of the first. He'll bat second for the Cubs here in the second as we lead the Brewers 2-0 here at County Stadium. Mickey Morandini will be the batter.
Jeff Cirillo thinks he's going to bunt. I haven't seen Mickey bunt to third too often.
And Roque pitches him outside. He showed no sign of a bunt that time for ball one. Big difference for Morandini between batting second and batting eight. Although leading off this half inning for the Cubs, that one fisted out of play.
Well, I like the fact that Cirillo is playing him in because it opens up a little more of a hole on that left side if Mickey goes that way. Normally you'd think he would be pulling Roque, who does not have an overpowering fastball. And there is a gap in right center field.
The 1-1. Off speed, he waited on it, popped it up behind third. Long run for Loretta. He makes it in foul ground. And Morandini's retired for out number one.
A couple of days ago, Jose Valentin had surgery on the ligament in his thumb. He's going to be lost for right around 2 months. That opened the door for Mark Loretta, who was their Jose Hernandez, a super sub on this team, playing all over and giving Phil Garner whatever he wanted. Now it opened the door for him at shortstop, and they're going to get a look at Loretta as an everyday player. This might come in handy because then, if he establishes the fact that he can do that on a regular basis, now you again have a trade possibility, either Valentin or Loretta.
Here's Steve Traxel looking for his first hit on the year. And Steve takes a ball outside.
This is a guy that Steve Traxel probably should hit well. Trax is a very good hitter.
That right through there evens the count, a ball and a strike. Well, we had 55,000 fans here yesterday, a great crowd. And a great opening day here at County Stadium. It's the last they'll enjoy here before moving into their new digs across the street. And they're expecting a crowd of over 27,000 here today on a chilly, cold, drizzly afternoon. Kind of a raw day today. One and two to Trax. Bouncing ball back to the mound. Roque should throw him out, and he does. Two up, two down here in the second. And we invite you to visit Galleons in Lombard and Schaumburg to enter the Swing Chicago Sweepstakes presented by Galleons, Louisville Slugger, and the Chicago Tribune. Throughout the year, six lucky contestants will have three chances to hit a home run out of Wrigley Field for $250,000. See your Chicagoland Galleons for more details and contest rules.
The Cubs come home against Houston and New York, and there are plenty of seats available for the Astros series. Tuesday the 20th and day games the 21st and 22nd against the Astros. Then the Mets come a-calling, and there are a few tickets left for that Mets series, but not Sunday. That's Sammy the Bear Beanie Baby Day, and they'll be packing a few folks in that day. So get your tickets to the Astros series.
And get there early. Arnie, I understand, was down at U-Haul picking out the biggest truck he could find for Beanie Baby Day, so make sure you show up for that one. We've got the pitching matchups for that series as well. We'll give them to you in just a moment as Manny Alexander hits for the second time today. It's out of play. Tomorrow it's Woodall against Woodard in the third and final game of the series, 1 o'clock here on WGN. We're off Monday. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, the Astros are in. Lieber against Lima on Tuesday. Sanders and Reynolds on Wednesday. Thursday, it'll be Steve Traxel against hot-hitting Sean Bergman. Manny strikes out. The Cubs are out in order. 1-2-3 in the second. After one and a half, Cubs 2, Brewers nothing. No time off for the construction crew across the street at Miller Park. They still say that thing's on pace, on schedule to be ready for opening day in the year 2000. And boy, it's going to be a beautiful facility with that retractable dome. We won't have to worry about the chilly weather ever again when we play baseball here in Brew City.
It should be a beautiful stadium, capacity around 43,000. And I'm sure it will get done as a couple of Phantom of the Opera fans at the ball game today. Not a bad idea. Keep your face away from the chill of Milwaukee in the early season.
So here's Burnett's, a five-game hitting streak for Jeremy Burnett's. And Traxel fires a ball outside, 1-0.
If you get ahead of Burnett, Steve Traxel will probably go to the fork ball. Anything off speed, changeups especially, just baffle Burnett's, but he's a good fastball hitter.
He had a three-run rocket yesterday. And he has really found a home here in Milwaukee. That was a great pickup by this Milwaukee organization to bring in Jeremy Burnett's. 2-0. And Steve pumps a strike over for a count of 2-1. Burnett's, last year, 38 home runs, 125 driven in. Steve misses outside, 3-1 the count.
Got to be careful here because Burnett's is looking for a fastball, one where he can extend his arm. He'll be trying to pull this one.
He has four hits against Steve. Three of them have left the ballpark. 3-1. That one popped right over our heads and out of play. Full count now, 3-2. Burnett's frustrated. He thought he had a pitch to hit. He was right on it, but got underneath.
It might be difficult for Steve Traxel because of the cold, but if he does have his forkball today, he's going to be able to strike out Burnett's on a forkball. We'll take a look at Benito Santiago. We'll see what he wants. That's a fastball. And that's the forkball.
Payoff pitch. He just did stay alive. Nobody on or out for the Brewers in the second. They trail the Cubs 2-0.
Burnett's just barely gets a piece of it. Hits just the top of the ball as it tried to sink under the bat.
They could use some of those arc welders in the seats here at County Stadium to keep folks warm. 3-2. Right back toward us and out of play. Get up, Stoney. 3-2.
I've got the hands of a sturgeon. You needn't fear, old chippy boy. I'll protect you.
A man whose crest is the yellow chicken. Three balls, two strikes. Here it is again. Struck him out. He pulled a string. Four up, four down. Good battle by Burnett's, but Traxel conquers him for the first time today.
There's an off-speed pitch, and that's the mystery for Burnett. He can't seem to hold up long enough, and he's a strikeout victim. Trax has got two of them.
And Burnett's has struck out now 13 times already on the year. Here's Sean Berry, a three-hit day yesterday. He's hitting .368, a homer and five runs batted in. He never got a lot of playing time with the Astros, but he's going to be their everyday first baseman here. Tough to crack a lineup down in Houston that had Billy Spires and Bagwell and Biggio and Alou in the outfield.
When he played down there, he played effectively, but he had a lot of injuries, especially shoulder injury.
Fouled out of play, one ball, one strike.
And that's one of the things, when he came on the market, obviously it was tempting for Ed Lynch. He looked at him, you look at that batting average, you look at those numbers, they look inviting, but when you realize that he really couldn't play third base on a regular basis and his one position was first, where Mark Grace resided, then he became a non-issue. So when the Brewers went to get him, they got him because they could open up first base with Jaha gone. They moved Nielsen behind the plate, gave first base to Berry.
A ball and a strike. Lined up the middle. Morandini knocks it down to his feet. Throws to first in time. And how about Mickey Morandini? He has made some unbelievable defensive plays here in the first 2 weeks.
Mickey was shading him up the middle, and Steve Traxel appreciates that kind of defense behind him. This is a rocket. And Mickey was able to get there, right the ship in time to throw him out at first. Well, hard hit ball, and Morandini has been sparkling defensively in this series.
And that ball was hit so hard it almost carried him into the outfield. But Morandini, a spectacular play to his right. It's five up, five down. Dave Nielsen, the batter, takes the ball inside. Cut Cubs 2, Milwaukee nothing. We're in the second at County Stadium. It's 2-0. Boy, it was great to see Warren Spahn at the ballpark yesterday throwing out the ceremonial first pitch.
Didn't quite make it to the plate, but at 78, you figure your best shot is good enough, especially when you completed 382 games
that's
lifetime.
Staggering, isn't it? Bouncing ball up the middle. Manny to his left this time. Plays Patty Cake and throws out Nilsson, who does not run well at all. Three up, three down. Steve Traxel perfect through two, and the Cubs enjoy a 2-0 lead.
Sorry.
Take another look at it. Take that one. Jose Hernandez, the great catch by Morandini, then the tumbling grab. Equally as effective on the natural surface as the artificial surface. Topped off with a sparkling play right here. Hopped off the mound, Mickey right there, bounces up and makes the play.
So not only is Mickey doing the boom boom thing with the bat, he's been doing it with the glove all year long. Jose Hernandez takes a strike as we move to the top of the third inning. Cubs 2 runs on 4 hits. Both runs scored on big two out hits, one by Hill, one by Santiago against Rafael Roque in the first. Right through there, 1-2.
25 game errorless streak for Mickey.
And the only question for him is, will he hit enough to win the gold glove?
That certainly is a factor.
Jose fists that ball out of play. That had to sting a little bit on a cold day. 1-2 the count.
Well, you see one of the big differences here and last inning as opposed to the first inning is Roque is using the inside corner. And I'm sure Bill Campbell told him that if you don't go in there, it's going to be a very short day for you.
The 1-2. He laid off. Two balls, two strikes. Well, you said earlier they need innings out of Roque today. And they need a win. Brewers 4-6 on the year. Two balls, two strikes. Again, fouled back. Good battle here. It's going to be very tough, I would imagine, to evaluate Phil Garner this year. He's in his eighth season as the manager of this Milwaukee team. He's done a terrific job. He's very highly considered around baseball. He's won 514 ball games as a skipper here. But he's in the final year of his contract. He's not been offered an extension, to our knowledge, at least not yet. And with the scarcity of starting pitching that they have, how can you evaluate the kind of job he has when you're fighting just to stay in the game for five innings?
Well, I think you bring up a good point. And for Phil Garner, who has the respect of all of his players, and they play hard for him, I think it'll be a difficult situation. And also this inning will shape up to be a difficult situation for Rafael Roque as he tries to navigate through the middle of the Cubs' suddenly potent order.
And he didn't want to do what he just did by walking Jose Hernandez, and now Mark Grace stands in. Grace singled and scored back in the first inning. Grace back to the batting gloves today on a frosty afternoon. Grace stands in. We want to send happy birthday greetings to Keith Conrad watching the ball game today. His mom Cheryl sent us a note asking us to mention Keith turning 17 today. He's a big Cub fan watching somewhere across the country and we're glad he's with us today. Upstairs to Grace, all one high. One ball, no strikes. Jose Hernandez, a leadoff walk in the third. He's going. The pitch. Swung. Line down the left field line. It's foul by an eyelash.
Terry Tata on the call, and that one just missed. And there's a good chance that if that's fair, Jose scores all the way from first. So a hit and run, lefty against lefty. And this one misses by a couple of inches. As Mark inside out to high fastball, having to protect Jose. And you see it foul by an eyelash.
So the count evens up at a ball and a strike. He just missed kissing the chalk down the left field line. So Hernandez back to first. Roque to the belt. The delivery is high, ball two. Big Cub fan Christian Castle watching the game today. Wants to send along happy birthday greetings to Pauline Hudson, his grandmother, watching in Danville, Virginia today. Pauline, happy birthday. And many more. Two runs, four hits for the Cubs were in the third. Jose, a good lead at first, and draws a throw. Other baseball in the National League. Pirates clobbering Cincinnati 5-1 in the top of the fifth inning. Jason Barré scheduled to start that game for the Reds today. Montreal and the Mets are tied at 2 in the fourth. And the Braves and Rockies do battle later on. That ball hit high in the air, deep toward left center field. Long run, Grissom. Now he slows down. The wind knocked it back to him. Grace is retired. Hernandez back to first, and there's out number one.
Well, it didn't appear that Mark Grace hit the ball all that hard. But indeed, that ball started to carry, and Grissom looked like he was going to have problems until it hit that wall of wind, and it just slipped right down.
Mixed reception now for Sosa. But well, there are a lot of Cub fans here.
Well, the Cub fans that were screaming in the first at bat were shouted out by a cascade of boos from the faithful Brewer fans, who don't appreciate that Sammy has only hit 13 home runs against their stalwarts over the last 13 games.
So Sosa bats with one on, one out here. And again, Roque to first. Sammy's strikeout in the first inning ended a string of 8 straight times he's reached base via a hitter walk. The pitch. He laid off the high heat. One ball, no strike. Stoney, we saw Sammy in Pittsburgh start to try to drive the ball to right field, and it's paid huge dividends here in the last 4 ball games.
Well, pitchers are going to stay away, and they did that consistently. So the advanced scouts who saw the first 2 series said, stay away from Sosa. He's pulling off everything. When he started to stay with his swing and look outside and take the ball that way, that stops pitchers from going out there consistently, and eventually they got to come inside. And when they come inside, that's what happened.
Not much doubt about that shot yesterday.
He didn't know it was gone because he didn't take the hop because it was a line drive. He thought it might sink before it got to the wall. It carried over fairly easily.
The 2-0. Off speed out in front. 2-1. Good pitch from Roque that time. He sold that pitch beautifully to Sam.
Sammy looking fastball all the way. He doesn't get it. And he doesn't get any contact.
Jose Hernandez led the inning off with a walk. The 2-1 pitch. Hop foul back out of play. Had a good rip. And the count evens up at 2-2.
We're happy to be here.
Very kind to the folks here in Milwaukee to welcome us. They've been very kind to us in our first year of National League Baseball here at County Stadium. And we look forward to another visit this year and, of course, Miller Park next year. This is a great baseball town, and I think that the move to the National League has done more for this town to energize it for baseball than any move, including a new ballpark, would have made.
Some of the people don't realize that the roots of this fine organization were in the National League with the Milwaukee Braves. There's a lot of Hall of Famers that went in wearing uniforms of the Braves.
It's amazing, too. You are told that the Milwaukee Braves were the first National League team to draw 2 million fans in a single season. The 2-2 backs him up. 3 balls, 2 strikes. And that includes the Brooklyn Dodgers, the New York Giants, St. Louis Cardinals. Boy, they've had some great players here. Robin, Yount, Henry, Aaron, Raleigh, Fingers.
Paul Molitor started here.
Man. Now 3 balls, 2 strikes.
If you have confidence in the changeup, be a good place to throw it if you're okay.
Jose, a big lead at first. One out, the 3-2 he's going. Delivery is ripped foul and out of play.
Semmy fought that one off. He got the strikeout inside last time, but Semmy able to spoil a pretty good pitch.
And even though Semmy strikes out a lot, it's not a huge risk to send base runners because Nielsen's had a terrible time throwing anybody out.
Not only Nielsen. There hasn't been one Brewer catcher throw anybody out all year. And that's one of the things that clubs will do against the Brewers. They will consistently test not only Nielsen, but Hughes and Banks.
The opposition 14 out of 14 in steals. That's not going to endear you to your manager or your pitcher. You can't throw anybody out.
And there is the number. But in all fairness to Nielsen and the catchers, they're saying that the pitchers haven't done a real good job of holding on base runners. So you work as a team.
The lead by Jose. Off he goes. The 3-2 swing. And again, Semmy fouls it back. And he is getting some monstrous cuts against Roque. But he hasn't been able to dial him in yet. And Roque looks like a man climbing the steps of the gallows. I don't want to throw another one to Semmy Sosa.
Well, if I'm Roque here, I give Jose my best move. Because I'd like to get another out before I have to go at Sosa again as he fouls it straight back, meaning he was right on that fastball. Beware at first, Jose, for the good move.
Again, the 3-2. He's off and running. Off-speed pitch at a mile high into shallow center field. In comes Marquise Grissom. He puts it away for out number two. So after the leadoff walk, two straight flyouts to center field. And now Glen Allen Hill will stand in. Big Cup fan Mary Rogers out of Farmington, Illinois, emails us and asks, what's up with Henry Rodriguez? He hasn't been playing of late. He still is bothered by that ribcage muscle pull.
And another factor, you've got Glen Allen Hill hitting well over 500. Driving in runs, 12th today. So you play the hot hand and you allow Henry to heal and get completely well before you even think about putting him back in the lineup.
Hill drove in his 12th run of the year in the first inning, a two-out single that scored Jose Hernandez. And there's a look at Henry, who hopes to be playing within a week. With this cold weather, that's a very, very touchy injury to have to overcome. Hernandez, a big lead at first. Now Roque steps off. In 54 games with the Cubs, Glen Allen Hill has hit 12 home runs and has driven home 35 and has hit over 375. And the first pitch is a ball low. Here's a look at our ComEd Power Profile featuring Glen Allen Hill.
The ComEd Power Profile is 6 starts to date, a robust 571 batting average, 4-12 on the power numbers, and Glen Allen Hill is our ComEd Power Profile.
One ball, no strikes. Bouncing ball up the middle. Pena can't get it. It's off his glove into center. Hernandez round second on his way to third. Hill is 2 out of 2, and the Cubs in business again. First and third with 2 men away.
Pena is a very good second baseman, but that time didn't look like he was able to get going. That ball went right back through the middle. Glen Allen Hill broke his bat as he hits it off the end. And Pena doesn't get a real good start on this ball and has the ball carry him away. It looks like a ball that he might have been able to play. He doesn't. Had he played it, they'd have gotten the force at second. Instead, runners at the corners for Benito.
So a second two-out hit for Hill. Santiago had a base hit with 2 outs in the first, and that scored the second Cub run. And as Annie Lennox and the Eurythmics would sing, here comes the rain again in Milwaukee. Cubs up 2-0. 5 hits. We're in the top of the third.
Okay, pitching like a man that is looking for that rain. As he's not rushing into this. And his stuff is not particularly sharp today.
Bonito with 6 RBIs. A chance for another one here. Line right center field. That'll drop for a hit. Hernandez scores. Hill round second. He's on the way to third. There'll be no throw. And the Cubs have scored again. It's 3-0. 4 2-out hits by the Cubs in this ball game. Something we've been looking for is finally starting to happen in the season's 10th game.
Fastball on the inner portion of Benito Santiago inside out this to right center field. The Cubs are making life miserable for Rafael Roque. They crushed him last year 10 earned runs in 10 and a third innings, and more of the same here today. He's given up 3 in 2 2/3 innings.
So Gaetti stands in. First and third, still two outs. Gaetti, a chopper to the shortstop. Funny hop for Loretta, but he'll flip DeVigne in time. And that retires the side. The leadoff walk comes back to harm the Brewers' left-hander, okay. After 2.5, Cubs 3, Brewers nothing. The Cubs are up 3 after 2.5 before the Brewers attempt to reach base for the first time against Steve Traxel here in the bottom of the third. Let's pause quickly for station identification.
This is America's number one sports station, WGN, Chicago.
With Steve Stone, Chip Caray, and our entire WGN crew from Milwaukee. A steady, misty, drizzly, nasty day at County Stadium. The umbrellas, the cheeseheads are out, and the fans seeking shelter from the inclement weather. And the Cubs hope to get 5 innings in, at least the way things have started. It's 3-0. Steve Traxel will face the lower third of the Brewer order. It's been 6 up, 6 down for Steve so far, who has been very, very sharp. In his first 2 starts, he struggled in the early innings. Today, he's had no such problem. Mark Loretta, the fine shortstop, leads things off. He's got a 5-game hitting streak on the line today. And Traxel just missed. Thought he had a strike there, 1-1.
Loretta showing bunt that brought Gary Gaetti in, and that'll take about 2 steps off the depth that Gaetti will play. He's even with the bag right now. He'll probably be coming in with the pitch.
Loretta's had very good luck lifetime against Traxel, 6-for-12 in his career, including a homer. But he's down to his last strike in this confrontation. 1-2 now. Breaking ball, fly ball, hit toward left center field. It'll be Jose Hernandez. He's got it. Here's on number 1. Went up, set him down. Some American League action to update you on now. In the top of the 6th inning at Fenway Park, the Red Sox lead the Devil Rays 7-4. Cleveland beating Minnesota 5-1. That now in the top of the 8th. A rain delay at Tiger Stadium in Detroit, where the Yankees will battle the Detroiters. And in the bottom of the 3rd inning, the Royals lead the White Sox in Kansas City 3-0. Here's Jeff Jenkins, and he takes a ball. Jenkins 0-for-4 in the series opener yesterday. Eyeing back toward us. And count evens 1-1.
Jenkins just missed a couple yesterday, got under it just like that. He's another man, a lot like Burnett. You can pull the string on him. Anything off speed mystifies him, but he does have a lot of power. And the Brewers think he's going to be a big run producer before it's all over. Right now hitting in the toughest spot to hit in the National League, the 8th spot.
Line down the left field line. That's trouble if it stays fair. It is foul and out of play. 1-2. So Traxel has Jenkins set up for his 3rd strikeout as rain continues to fall.
Favorite group.
Our thanks to Pete Toma and our entire crew for digging up the CD reference and the vast musical library that they keep with them from city to city here in the 99 campaign. 1-2. Evens the count, 2 balls, 2 strikes. Reed, a nothing Cubs, trying to go to 5-5 on the year. Now Traxel, a 3-ball, 2-strike count to Jenkins.
Well, now
Jenkins has
go
never reached with a hit against Steve in his young career.
Well, now you have to go the fastball 3-2. You don't want to walk him. Set up the bunt by Roque, so throw it down the middle, see how far he can hit it.
Payoff pitch He lost him. A one-out walk to Jenkins, the number eight hitter, and now Roque will stride to the plate. First walk for Traxel, and Roque 0 for 3 on the year. We'll have a mind to bunt the man over.
No sacrifices so far. He hasn't stayed around very long in his previous two starts, but he'll have an opportunity here to lay one down, and he wants to make sure that Mark Grace fields it.
They want to keep Jenkins close at first. Again, it's been drizzling throughout the start of this ball game, so a bunt, got to be very careful with how you handle it, because that baseball is going to come up very slick. And he got the bunt down, but it's to Gaetti. He doesn't even look at second. He'll throw to first. Good sacrifice. 5-4. The runner to second now. Two outs for the tough Fernando Vina.
Okay, successful on his first attempt at a sacrifice. And he deadens the ball just enough, so Gaetti only has one play.
So Vina the batter. He popped out to third his first time up. He's 1 for 5 in the series. Jenkins with decent speed stands at second. He represents what could be the first Milwaukee run. Steve Traxel's got a 3-0 lead. And that's right through there, 0-1. Same two teams tomorrow. Brad Woodall for the Cubs, Steve Woodard for Milwaukee. And we'll have it for you here on WGN. No balls and a strike. Line drive hit high in the air toward right center field. It's tailing back toward Sammy. He's there. He's got it. And the inning is over. The perfect game is spoiled, but Traxel's got a no-hitter through three. And more importantly, he leads the ballgame 3-0. Cubs 3, Brewers nothing after 3. And Stoney, time to take a look at our Hit It Big report brought to you by the Illinois Lottery. Encouraging news for that man.
Jeremy Gonzalez on a 30-pitch count got to 32 pitches. The control was good, 21 strikes, and a very encouraging outing. So for the Illinois Lottery, Jeremy Gonzalez was hitting it big yesterday.
Mickey Morandini leads things off and pops it foul out of play. It's 0-1. With Steve Stone, I'm Chip Caray. Very special guest in the booth as well. Trumpeter Chuck Mangione is here.
How you doing, Chuck? It's nice to see you. Did a nice job with the Star Spangled Banner.
Not my favorite song. I always thought America the Beautiful should be our anthem, but it's a great way to get a good seat at a ball game, I'll tell you.
Fly ball to right off the bat of Mickey Morandini. There's one away here in the fourth.
Now you have your best friend with you, and I asked you if you had a few more of those, and you said that maybe just one backup, but this is your favorite.
This one's my main squeeze. Dizzy Gillespie told me one time, a horn is like a woman. If you don't hug it during the day, at night when it's time to play, there ain't nothing happening. So I keep it real close to me.
Well, we got to ask you if you can play the, what's that, what do they call that when they send the racehorses to the track? Arnie Harris likes to hear that song. Oh, the hair on the back of Arnie's neck is at full attention.
We were talking earlier about Don Zimmer, of course, and every time I play that when I'm at Yankee Stadium, he kind of levitates off the bench. You know?
I've never known Zim to place a wager on anything.
Oh, not Don. Did you ever play in Rochester?
I did not. I didn't come up with the Baltimore organization, but for years I know that was their AAA club, and quite obviously Joe Altobelli is a Mr. Rochester, and so many of the great players, I know Don Baylor and Bobby Gritch notably, as well as many of the other Orioles came through that area.
Even before that, I saw some great players play, because I'm from Rochester, New York, and if I can impose, I'd like to, my parents are 88 and 86, and they're in Rochester watching this game, so I'd like to say, how you doing, Mama and Papa?
More than happy to do that for you. 1-2 to Steve Traxel. He lays off the breaking ball. And the count now 2-2.
And I know you guys are currently touring, and certainly I encourage the people to go out and see you. Where are you going next?
Well, we'll be here in Milwaukee tonight. Next week we're going to be in Albuquerque and Las Vegas. The following week we'll be in New Orleans, and then we go to Disney World and to Jacksonville, Florida, and then we go to Poland. So we travel. Actually, there's, I think, a great correlation between ball players and musicians. You know, you're always under scrutiny. You get a review every night, you know, and even in a place like this, when you play with the echo, it's kind of like instant replay. If you make a mistake, you're going to hear it back three times. So I think, you know, you go out and you're on the road a lot, and you have, keep your batting average up there. Some days you have a great night and other nights, but it's a great feeling to play for people.
Manny Alexander, a little pop to the right side that Fernando Vina takes care of. And that retires the side for the Cubs in the fourth. Chuck, great to meet you. All the best. Thanks for stopping by. Hope your folks are doing well, and we hope to see you again soon this summer. Bottom half of the fourth comes your way. Cubs 3, Milwaukee nothing. Honor Discover Platinum Payback Playback today. We look back to yesterday's around-the-horn triple play turned by the Brewers. The 5-4-3 triple was the second triple play the Cubs have hit into in as many years, and the first by the Brewers in 2 years. Not something you see every day. A triple play. That's today's Discover Payback Playback. We go to the bottom of the fourth inning. The Brewers still looking for their first hit. And Stoney's still looking for his first bratwurst of the series.
Oh, new, new, new.
Oh, they're extra good today, pal. You're missing out. As Marquise Grissom strides to the plate, he struck out his first time on his birthday, number 32 today. Traxel has pitched very effectively. A one-hop rocket right to Morandini. One pitch, one out here in the fourth inning. Milwaukee's hitting some atom balls at us.
That was a one-hop rocket, and Mickey stayed right in front of it. Might not have wanted to, but he did. Was able to make the play.
Traxel's looking back at Mickey saying, "You all right, pal?"
Move back a little bit.
Morandini looks like that baseball got a piece of it, a little more than he's letting on. But Grissom is retired, and Cirillo will stand in. He bounced out to the shortstop his first time up. Cirillo hitting 233 on the campaign. I firmly believe if this guy played in New York, Chicago, Los Angeles, Atlanta, he'd be a much bigger name than he is here in Milwaukee. He's a very, very talented, gritty, hard-nosed player. No balls and a strike. Evens up the count.
We'll take a look at that play again, and Mickey took one right in the midsection. And he came up with it and threw him out.
That's going to leave a mark, I would imagine, on a cold day. The pitch way out in front, 1-2.
Good split finger by Steve Traxel, just disappeared under the Cirillo bat. Cirillo hit 321 last year. Didn't give you the kind of power you'd expect at third with just 14 home runs, but he gives you a great glove, made 10 errors all year long on the front end of 45 double plays, and that was tied for the league lead. This is a good, solid player.
Steve misses high and away. Two balls, two strikes. Lance gets the day off today. He'll probably be back in there tomorrow. Manny Alexander gets his first start of the year today at shortstop, moving Jose Hernandez into center field for the Cubs. The 2-2. Missed with a breaking ball. The count now full. Jeremy Burnett's waiting on deck. You'd like to retire Cirillo when you face Burnett's, for he has tremendous power. Cubs 3, Milwaukee nothing in the fourth. And that's out of play.
Yesterday, Burnett got the Brewers back into the game. The Cubs seemingly having it all their own way at 6-0. Burnett's hit a three-run homer, and it became a ball game as the Brewers closed to within two before the Cubs finally put it away. So you retire Cirillo, and Burnett's cannot hit a two-run homer. And there's John Lieber, who's been brilliant. 2 8-inning performances, throwing the ball as well as anybody in the league right now.
3-2 again. Lined into center field, right center field. Jose will watch it drop in front of him. And there's the first Milwaukee hit. Jeff Cirillo lines a single into right center field very cleanly. And Burnett will bat with a chance to make it a one-run ball game.
Right fielder, Jeremy Burnett.
About the 6-0 lead, and Jeremy Burnett's got a fastball, got it up in the wind. He didn't think he hit it out. You can see almost the look of disgust on his face. thinking he had just popped up the ball to right field. A three-run homer ensued.
It didn't clear the fences by much, but it was good enough. As Scott Sanders couldn't hold the 6-0 lead, the Cubs won the game, but he didn't get the win. So he'll hope for better tidings Wednesday against Houston. Here's Burnett's way out in front, 0-1.
Another off-speed pitch, and another swing and a miss.
Burnett struck out swinging, leading off the Milwaukee second. Cubs 3-0. Cirillo has yet to attempt a stolen base in the 1999 campaign. A fair-sized lead over at first, not going. The pitch, bouncing ball to the right side. Morandini will flip the second one, and that's the only play that Manny has. So Cirillo's retired 4-6 on the force out. One on, two away now, and the first baseman Sean Berry stands in.
And credit Cirillo with going in hard at second. Manny had ideas of trying to turn the double play, but he found himself flat-footed awaiting the throw of Morandini. You can't get much on the throw if you take that posture at second. And with Cirillo coming in hard, Manny thought better of throwing the ball to first. Watch it. It's not the way you want to turn the double play, but with Cirillo coming in, you don't get it anyway.
So Brenitz trades places with Cirillo, and Sean Berry stands there now. He grounded to second his first time up. And that misses downstairs. Pirates leading the Reds now 5-4. Our old buddy Brant Brown, a couple of doubles in that game for the Pittsburgh team. Chris Peters started for Pittsburgh. Jason Barea lasted just a third of an inning for Cincinnati. One ball, no strikes to Barry. Good breaking ball. Steve's got all of his pitches working in this game, unlike what we saw the first two times out.
Well, I think he came into this one with a little more determination. It also is a pitcher's day. Steve Traxel making the most of it, but you're right, Chip. The fork ball, the fastball, the command of the outside corner, and a better curveball than we've seen him throw recently. That last one was a very good breaking pitch.
The count now even at a ball and a strike. Another breaking ball. This one lined at Sosa in right field. He's there. He's got it. And the inning is over. No runs, one hit, one man left. Four innings complete in Milwaukee. We're delighted you're with us on a cold and chilly Saturday. Cubs 3-0. Cubs 3-0 as we head to the fifth. And Cubs fans, plenty of good seats are still available for games throughout the 1999 season. And Wrigley Field's a great place to spend your summer, and mark your calendars now. For group or season tickets, dial 773-404-CUBS. For individual tickets, stop by the Wrigley Field box office, Ticketmaster, or call 312-831-CUBS. An off day Monday, then the Astros will come a-calling. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, then the Mets, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Here's Jose Hernandez, the heart of the Cub order, against Rafael Roque, who has been very shaky so far.
Jose's been on twice. He's scored twice. And that's the kind of table setter you want at the top. But getting a little play in center field today.
That pitch again buzzsaws his chin. Two balls, no strikes.
This is one of the more spacious center fields in the league. You've got 392 to the power alleys. It's tough to hit the ball out in straightaway center or in those gaps.
Right through there. Two balls and a strike to Jose Hernandez. The Cubs have had a parade of two out hits today, and that's how they've scored all three runs. A two out hit by Glenn Allen Hill, a two out hit by Benito Santiago in the first, and another two-out hit from Santiago in the third scored Hernandez. Steve Traxel's been terrific with four innings of one-hit starting pitching for the Cubs. The 2-2. Off speed, hit sharply to third. Good play, Cirillo. Clean pickup, good throw, one away.
The last time Jose saw a changeup was in the first inning when he doubled to left. This time he hits a one-hop rocket right at Cirillo, who's as sure-handed as they get at third base, and he makes the play easily.
Big Cub fans, Bob and Louise Bruce from Marshalltown, Iowa, watching the game today. Hope the weather is nicer there than it is here. It was nasty in Des Moines yesterday, as Hideo Nomo's second start was snowed out. He'll go tonight, however, as the Iowa Cubs will host Las Vegas. Grace pulls that ball right to bury it first. Another clean stab. And there's out number two.
Mark Grace probably wondering what he's doing wrong. He can't hit the ball any harder.
Right fielder.
And he's just barely over 300. But he keeps hitting rockets, and they keep going right at Brewer players.
So here's Sammy. He'll bat for the first time when the base is empty today. He is struck out looking, and he's flied to shallow center. Those kids have been on their feet every time Sosa has been up. As Sammy pulls that ball foul past third, that burger box might make a suitable glove if it heads. Their way. Summerlin likes those McNuggets too. No balls and a strike. Off speed, hit high in the air, deep towards center, but playable for Grissom. And he's got it. The inning is over. Roque has settled down. He's retired seven in a row. The Cubs go out 1-2-3 for the second straight inning. We're halfway home in Brew City. Cubs 3, Milwaukee nothing. Well, Stoney, time to tell our fans when they can catch the Cubs. A look at the upcoming schedule brought to you by Pepsi AC.
It's the Brewers again tomorrow. Then after the off day Monday, the Astros Tuesday night, Wednesday afternoon, Thursday afternoon. That's the upcoming schedule for the new Pepsi AC Chewable.
As we head to the bottom of the fifth inning, Steve Stone, Chip Caray, and the Commissioner of Baseball, Bud Selig, kind enough to join us. Couldn't you have arranged some 80-degree weather for us, pal?
I was just going to ask Chip, you and Steve. I put you two guys in control here. This is, I'm a little nervous looking up because I'm afraid we're going to see a little snow before this is over.
Well, we got lucky yesterday as Nilsson tries to bunt his way on. Guyette charges. He'll have to put it in his pocket. How about that? Nilsson, a bunt single leading off the fifth.
Well, the flying feet of Dave Nielsen, always a threat to lay one down, Bud, and he winds up in pretty good shape. But he saw Gaddy back at third and figured they need base runners. Why not?
Well, that's I've watched Dave Nielsen play for a long time, and I must admit I am surprised. But,
well, obviously, congratulations on what took place here yesterday and all the excitement surrounding your former organization, this Milwaukee ball club with the ballpark across the street. But it had to be a day of many mixed emotions for you here yesterday.
Well, it did, Chip. You know, it was unusual driving here yesterday. I started thinking back to all the opening days, and I've really seen every one of them, and starting with Warren Spahn beating the Cardinals back in 1953. You two guys weren't even born yet.
I wish I could say that.
Steve, I'm trying to be kind. Today's my day to be kind.
That pops away from Santiago Nielsen to second. Don't be kind to him.
No?
No. He can handle it.
All right. Well, I'll pound on him like I usually
please.
Do.
Absolutely.
Okay?
Please. I need all the help I can get.
All right. Actually, I want to blame somebody for the bad weather, so why don't we blame Steve?
That sounds good. On. All the best.
But there have been a lot of great opening days here, and I guess my favorite opening day here, and it was Sixto Lascano's grand slam home run in 1980 to beat the Boston Red Sox off Dick Drago. There was something really exciting. But when you look at that new structure over there at Miller Park, they're going to be in good shape here once they get over there.
Will it be done in time for opening day next year?
They assure me that it will, and I'm there when I'm in town. I go over once a day or drive from downtown to see it. And I've only hit one cement truck the last 8 months, so I think I'm doing pretty well.
One ball, no strikes to Mark Loretto with a runner at second. The Brewers down three.
But how difficult was it to spend so many years coming to this ballpark in your office on a daily basis, day after day, year after year? And finally, when you became the Commissioner of Baseball, you had to change your office and move downtown.
Yeah, and I travel a lot. It's really different. I tell you, Chip, Steve, I sort of crossed that Rubicon about a year ago when I was debating about taking it. You know, Steve, I lived and died on every pitch and every inning, and had a lot of
walking on these ramps.
A lot of walking on the ramps, a lot of temper tantrums, all that. But I can say this, nobody misses them. So, but I worried about all that, and I worried about my ability to do that, and I had to satisfy myself that I could. You know, having said that, and maybe it was the 6 years of preparation, I've made the move, and I really, yesterday was the first time I'd seen the Brewers play this year. And I have to say, while my heart is always obviously will be very much in Milwaukee, and I want them to do well, I really have moved on.
Women are playing a bigger role in baseball with every passing year, and of course the president of this ball club is your daughter. Now I know you have a bit of a prejudiced view, but did she learn enough baseball over the years to be a quality executive at this point?
There isn't a doubt in my mind. I mean, there's some things, and you know, you worry about those things, and I'm sure that she did too. I will tell you, and I can say this, and she's wanted to do this since she was 7 or 8 years old. Became a Cub fan, by the way, after the Braves left Milwaukee, so that trained her for a lot of things. I'll let you determine.
There's no doubt about that.
And but the answer is, for all those who have dealt with her in baseball, around baseball, other executives, she is so qualified to do this job. Now, years ago, couldn't have happened, daughter or no daughter. And we need to do a lot more of that with women and other minorities and so on and so forth. But, yeah, Steve, the answer is unequivocally yes. And I'll let the rest of the world determine it. I can assure you she will be an extraordinary baseball executive.
But this is the final season in the 20th century for Major League Baseball, the sport kind of at a crossroads in many different areas. Can you give us a thumbnail sketch of the state of the game as you see it, and what's your vision for the game of baseball is going to be as we get ready for the year 2000?
Well, I have a lot of visions, Chip, and I, the state of the game is, I don't think it's ever been more popular.
That ball drilled down the left field line, long run for Glenn Allen Hill, but at the edge of the track, he'll hold it in. Loretta's retired. Nilsson's tagging. He'll head to third. He'll slide in safely with one man out now.
Boy, Nilsson's getting to be a speed merchant on the bases.
I don't know what happened. Yesterday he couldn't run. All of a sudden today, he's off to the races.
The game's never been more popular. I hope we're going to set another attendance record at both the major and minor league levels. I think our television ratings will be very solid. All the criteria are good. The renaissance I keep talking about is there's no question it is taking place. Underneath, and there's no sense of hiding this, we all know there's a disparity problem, and there are significant number of things that need to be solved. But there's no doubt in my mind, Chip, that we will solve those. And in fact, I'm going to spend most of the next couple of weeks on the disparity question. But other than that, international is a huge area. There's so much going on right now. I hope we're going to open the season in Japan next year. You know, we've been to Cuba, been to Mexico. Hopefully we'll open in Japan. I think the next expansion will be international. We have a lot of things to do with rights and other things that we really need to do. So I'm very comfortable where we are right now, but there is work to be done, frankly. But the game, this should be really a spectacular year.
We sure hope so, too.
But as a way of evening things out, do you envision a worldwide draft on the horizon for baseball?
The answer is yes. Yes, Steve. There isn't a doubt in my mind that there are many things we can do to level the playing field. And one of the things that needs to be done, because the disparity has even grown, as you know, in the farm system and in scouting and in player development. And so, yes, I think a worldwide draft makes a lot of sense. We have some hoops to jump through, but I think that'll take place. There's a series of other things. We're going to be very active in the next year or two. There are many changes to be made. There are things to be done. But one thing you never want to do is tamper with the game itself, because it is the greatest game in the world.
Jeff Jenkins is the batter. The count to him is nothing and two. Cubs leading the Brewers 3-0. We're joined by the Commissioner of Baseball, Bud Selig. We've been talking to Bud the last day and a half or so about how baseball has enjoyed a renaissance throughout the game, but certainly in this town with the move of the Brewers back into the National League. The Milwaukee franchise back into the National League as Jenkins strikes out. You've been a proponent of more realignment. That's something you're still pushing for. Is that something you think is realistically going to happen in the next year or so?
Well, it has to happen because we have some schedule. We have weaknesses in the structure of the schedule. I think a lot of people don't understand that. And I know the first realignment plan was called radical, and I was sorry about that. And I don't believe we'll have anything like that. I think there will be a phase two, because we need a phase two to cure some of the structural problems. But having said that, I think that the phase two will be maybe two or three teams, maybe four teams, and that hopefully will solve some of the problems that we have. I've had a lot of clubs complain to me in the last week or two about their schedule, and I think it's validly so in many cases, some not so valid. But and I've said to them, but the only thing that will cure that is some realignment. They now understand that. But it'll be a modest deal.
And how about expansion, Bud? The last one, very successful, obviously. The Diamondbacks and the Devil Rays came in. A lot of excitement in those two cities. But will it be a while for the next expansion?
Steve, if I had a guess, you know, you're always a little, you do it with some trepidation. I think we're a long, long ways away from any more expansion. I just can't foresee any expansion right now. And let me say to you, I can't see it for my term, which has 5 years to go. What happens after that, I'll have to let all of you worry about it.
Rich Becker, the pinch hitter for Rafael Roque, with a runner at third, now two outs. And Traxel misses outside to even the count, 1-1. It's still a 3-0 Cub lead. We're in the bottom half of the fifth, and rays of sunshine popping through the
amazing
overcast.
Steve is all
you
right.
You show up in the booth, Mr. Well, Commissioner.
You're giving me credit, and I was giving Steve credit. So.
It's become a very nice day, and the fact right. that we haven't had a rain delay, I think, is a miracle to this point.
It is a miracle.
In the last 2 days.
You know, I'm talking about renaissance.
Becker sends a drive, hit deep toward left. Back goes Hill. He's there. He's got it. And the inning is over. Can you stay with us another half inning?
I sure can.
All right, Bud Selig, the Commissioner of Baseball, the ballpark big enough to hold that blast. From Becker, on to the sixth we go. Cubs 3, Milwaukee nothing. Just 79 home games remaining here at Historic County Stadium in Milwaukee, and then they'll move across the street to new Miller Park, and the construction crew still hard at work on that beautiful 40,000-seat facility beyond the outfield fences here in Milwaukee. With Steve Stone, I'm Chip Caray, and the Commissioner of Baseball, Bud Selig. Bud, we talked briefly about realignment. We've talked briefly about expansion. There are three cities really that have some ownership issues that have to be resolved. Montreal has a horrible problem still north of the border. The Cincinnati Reds ownership situation has still muddled. It's going to court now. And the Oakland Athletics are apparently on the market as well. How do you address those situations, and what role will that play in any realignment issues that ownership might take up?
Well, they do. When you asked about realignment, those do. Let me cover them. Montreal, we're, of course, monitoring closely, and I'm deeply concerned, Chip. I don't mind telling you. I'm very troubled. We haven't moved a team in 28 years. We're very proud of that fact. Baseball has been by far the most stable sport. Believe in all that. We want to continue to. But I must tell you, I have a lot of concerns about Montreal, and I, time will tell, but we don't see a lot of progress being made.
Are you concerned too, though, Mr. Selig, that are you running out of markets to take teams to? I mean, once you get past the Northern Virginias of the world, are there other places to put teams that you think are big enough geographically and
population? Well, there are, Chip, although you're right. I mean, there are not a lot of markets out there. That's why when the argument goes, when you hear about baseball economics and some people tell you, well, then you got to start moving teams. Well, I mean, where are you going to move them all?
Exactly,
I mean,
right.
You can't. But the answer is yes. I hope the Montreal situation works out, but candor impels me to tell you that I am very concerned about it. Oakland, well,
a roller to the right side. David Weathers, the new pitcher for Milwaukee. He handles the toss from Barry Cleaner.
Sitting to my right, sitting to my right, hopefully, will be the solution to the Oakland situation.
Well, he's got deep pockets. I know that because he never picks up a dinner check. So.
Is that right? That's good. I'll remember that, too. I'll remember that, too, Steve. But I am, all kidding aside, I'm very hopeful. I know that... Steve is a very integral part of a group that is coming forward very, very shortly. And I think that hopefully that will be at least the solution to that. The Cincinnati situation is now in court. And it's hard for me to comment other than I hope that the court action, frankly, finally solves that problem, and I believe it will, Chip.
You know, but that's just a great baseball town, always has been, and you like to see that town solidified. I know they're going to get a new stadium, and Jim Bowden's done a great job on a short payroll, and certainly those fans deserve to have the situation resolved, and it appears that it's going to be.
I agree with you. They do deserve. It is a wonderful baseball town with a really great tradition, and it is. It's. But I think, frankly, I feel good about that. I think we're coming to a solution there. And so I have concerns about Montreal and the other two. I will work out, and Steve's going to help me work out the Oakland situation.
And I didn't even mention the Minnesota situation as well.
I have concerns there, too. I'm going up to Minnesota at the end of the month, and that's a wonderful market. And I happen to be a great fan of Carl Polad's, and I know there's been problems up there, but we got to get those solved. But, frankly, in both Minnesota and Montreal, there's no other way to say it. They can't survive without a new facility. I don't care who the owner is, and I don't care what the situation is. They can't survive without another situation, without a new stadium. And that's just the way the situation is.
And, Bud, the other big issue, I guess, as we start the season, is the situation with the umpires. We hear about the so-called change to the strike zone, the high strike being called. We haven't seen a whole lot of those pitches being called, but we see seemingly one or two a ball game, as if to say, guys, we're going to call it. Here it is.
We usually see one late, and it's usually a high curveball.
Santiago strikes out. How do you see baseball's relationship with umpires as they enter the final year of their contract with Major League Baseball, and is this change of the strike zone going to be an effective one, you think?
Well, I do think it's going to be effective. The relationship with the umpires will be fine because they're professional, and what we're trying to do, quite frankly, is just get the strike zone to be called the way it's supposed to be called.
And uniformly in both leagues,
and
right?
And uniformly in both leagues. One of the things, you know, is interesting. Everybody, wherever I go, I talk to people about umpiring. When I was down in St. Louis in September, I spent 3 days with Stan Musial watching McGuire and Sosa. I talked to Warren Spahn yesterday. Hank Aaron and I had a conversation about it last Thursday night. It's been great. I've been talking to old-timers, and all of them say there were always some differences between the American and National League, but not huge. But never these huge differences within the league. And I think, Steve, you would agree. There's no question, and Chip, you're seeing variances. And that's all that Sandy Alderson and Paul Beeston and all the others.
So will we see just Major League umpires and not National and American League umpires?
Well, we haven't made that decision yet, but I will tell you this. I have some ideas on structure to change that will make things more efficient.
Mr. Commissioner, great to see you. All the best.
Chip,
congratulations.
Thank
here
you.
In Milwaukee.
You too.
We'll
Steve,
see you down
good
the
to
road.
See you. Thanks, guys.
Bud Selig, 3-0 Cubs here in the middle of the sixth. All right, thanks again to the Commissioner of Baseball, Bud Selig, for joining us for an inning or so. Good news from Milwaukee. Cubs lead the Brewers 3-0. Big two-out hits early on for the Cubs, and great Steve Traxel pitching so far.
Steve Traxel in control. And it's to the top with Fernando Vina. So the third time through the order, hopefully, will not be tricky for Steve Traxel, who's absolutely been brilliant thus far.
Well, the top four hitters are 1-for-8 for Milwaukee in this game. Their top five are 1-for-10. Brewers only have two hits on the day, and if you keep Vina off the base paths, you help yourself tremendously.
Well, you have to be careful if you go inside to Vina, because he doesn't mind getting hit by a pitch. He did that quite a bit last year. He was second in the league in that dubious department. So he doesn't get out of the way. He just gets hit and takes first.
No balls and a strike to Vina. Breaking ball rolled foul past Ron Jackson, the first base coach here in Milwaukee. And the count is now 0-2. Some interesting comments from Bud Selig. Very concerned about the Minnesota and Montreal situations.
And I think what he was talking about, you know, there is a big hurdle in the umpiring, and you'd like to get that solidified, because as we move along into the next millennium, baseball is going to thrive. And the one thing Bud said that I wholeheartedly agree with, Chip, is that we are going into a renaissance period. It was
no doubt
certainly kindled last year with the home run chase.
Vina, a little roller to short. Good play by Manny. Nice job. Vina 0-for-3. Boy, he took a chance. The in-between hop. He just got the leather underneath the baseball and threw out a speedy base runner for out number one.
Well, Steve Traxel has to be very happy with the defense behind him today, because it's been excellent. Manny Alexander, an off-balance throw. Mickey Morandini's been terrific at second. And the outfield has been equal to the task. So good pitching goes hand-in-hand with good defense. Steve Traxel has had a little of everything today.
Marquise Grissom, the batter, 0-for-2 on his birthday today. What I thought was encouraging, too, was his talk about the realignment. And I know there are purists who don't like that fact or don't like to consider that it's something that needs to happen or should happen in the opinion of the commissioner. But what I'm most encouraged about is that the owners seemingly, or at least some of them, are saying, hey, we need this now. The schedule is so messed up, we've got to do something to help ourselves. And if they can start with that small thing, maybe they can agree on some other things, too, that will be beneficial to the game. Grissom right up the elevator shaft. Santiago has a beat on it, fires the mask out of harm's way, and Grissom is retired for out number two.
Well, I asked him a question, Chip, and one of the things that I wholeheartedly agree with is a worldwide draft, for the simple reason that it stops the very wealthy clubs from coming in and taking the pitchers that might come out of Cuba or from the Pacific Rim or areas where they can come into the country, perhaps through Costa Rica, not be draft eligible. And so the teams that can spend $12, $15, $20 million get all of the good players, and they perpetuate the organization by doing just that. You don't have to sign players through scouting and development. You can let somebody develop them elsewhere and then just outbid everybody. And I think that's a way to get back to not even keel, but certainly make it a little more competitive and put the onus on scouting and development once again.
Cirillo takes a strike, but it's obvious if you've listened to anything Bud Selig has said, if you've read anything that's been written about him or that he has written, some sort of revenue plan has to be put in place, in his opinion, to further along the slimming of that gap between the haves and have-nots in baseball. I don't know how that's going to happen. I don't know if ownership will allow that to happen, but certainly it's impossible for the Montreals to compete with the New Yorks of the world.
Imagine going into either the American League East or the National League East on short money. Very difficult to compete with some of the real high revenue teams and go into a championship season with the idea that you're going to be competitive, and if you have a couple career years from your guys, you just might win it.
Two balls and a strike to Cirillo, and again our thanks to the commissioner Bud Selig for stopping by. It's always nice to see him here in Milwaukee. A strike from Traxel, 2-2. It has to pull at his heartstrings a bit to no longer be involved day to day here. His office was right outside the ticket office here in Milwaukee at County Stadium forever here. Now he's got an office downtown along with the office in New York City. But he responsible for bringing the old Seattle Pilots back to Milwaukee. And he remembers as a kid watching this ballpark being built. He's seen his whole life in this stadium, and he'll see it move into a new phase with Miller Park next year. 2-2 to Cirillo. He went around, and it's foul tipped, caught by Santiago, and Traxel mows him down 1-2-3 in the bottom of the sixth inning. Steve Traxel is looking very sharp on what's turned out to be a very bright sunny day at County Stadium. 3-0 Cubs. With Steve Stone, Chip Caray at County Stadium in Milwaukee. A beautiful Saturday finally at the ballpark. And a beautiful day for the Cubs hitters. Four clutch two-out hits. And Steve Traxel, a two-hit shutout so far.
Well, the Cubs are going to contend, and they plan to do just that in the Central. They have to have Steve Traxel throwing the ball very well. And it's hard to believe that he would throw the ball much better than he's thrown it today. He's limited a very good Brewer team to just two hits. And make no mistake, this team has pitching problems. They don't have a lot of problems in their offensive lineup, but Steve Traxel's handcuffed them today.
Mickey Morandini leads things off against David Weathers. Rafael Roque started for the Milwaukee team, gave Phil Garner five good innings. He was very shaky to start the last couple, certainly very encouraging for the Brew crew.
If Phil Garner can get through this one using just two, possibly the third pitcher for an inning, he would be very happy. He'd give some rest to that bullpen going into tomorrow's game.
That is something they certainly need, as the Cubs and Brewers play again tomorrow, and then the St. Louis Cardinals come a-calling. So the task not very easy at all for Milwaukee's moundsmen here as they play their first six games of the year here at home. Oh, you can tell it's getting hot.
Oh,
Sammy's
yeah.
Fans taking off. Well, they're putting them back on. I guess it's not quite warm enough.
Not that hot.
Morandini is 0-2 today. And he faces a 1-2 count from David Weathers. And he just did stay alive. We're back at it again tomorrow, 1 o'clock Chicago time for the third game of the series. Brad Woodall will face his former mates. Steve Woodard will pitch for Milwaukee. Then we'll bus back home, have Monday off, and then welcome the Astros to town starting Tuesday.
2-2 to Mickey Morandini. Steve Traxel waiting on deck. A win today by the Cubs gives us a three-game winning streak and a 500 record. And now Morandini's battle to run the count full, 3-2.
And as so often happens in this wild and wacky Central, a 500 record puts you squarely in the middle of a race that should stay close all year long. St. Louis off to a good start despite having some pitching problems, 6-3.
Morandini inside the bag at third. He'll round first. He'll chug towards second. And he'll make it on a slide. A cue ball shot just inside the third base bag. And look at Cirillo over there. He can't believe that ball stayed fair.
Can't believe it was called fair. He thought that was on the other side of the line, but he was well off the line as Mickey takes a big swing and guides it right down the third base line. Mickey rooting for it to stay fair. It does just that. And Terry Tatum, who's called everything today foul, finally gets the motion toward the field of play. And the Cubs looking for an all-important insurance run. You got to figure with nobody out, Traxel will be bunting the third base and try to make Cirillo field it.
So a chance for Steve to help himself today. He's 0-2. A comebacker to the mound and a strikeout swinging back in the fourth. Every run is very important against this Milwaukee team. They can put some runs on the board very quickly. Traxel, a bunt right in front of the plate. Nilsson picks it up, throws to third. Morandini's tagged out. And Steve upset with himself as he didn't get the job done.
But a very good play by Dave Nilsson, who moved from first base and the outfield to back behind the plate this year. He pounces on this bunt. It is not a good one. But a good play by Nilsson as he throws a strike. And Mickey is actually safe at third, by the way. He gets the hand in well ahead of the tag. And the hand's on the bat. He came off the bag, apparently. He lifted it off, called him out.
So Lance Johnson pinch hits here. That's a bad break for the Cubs. That would have been a very big run. So now Traxel runs the bases with the jacket on. Lance Johnson comes on to pinch hit for Manny Alexander. And Lance swings the first ball, grounds up the middle. Vigna flips to Loretta at short. On to first, it's not in time. Johnson hustling down the line. Loretta was surprised. Vigna gave him the ball, it appeared. But they got the leading lady at second base for out number two.
Well, Vigna would have never been able to complete the double play because all his momentum would have taken him well across the bag. So he figures the best way to do it is to get it to Loretta. Bare hand, throw to first. But Lance beats the play and beats the double play to keep the inning alive. Normally, you want to take that ball and throw just as you're stepping on the bag. You might have completed the double play that way, but Loretta had a step and a half to go, and they didn't get it done.
So let's see if Lance does any running now with two men out. He's got Jose Hernandez in the batter's box. Cubs 3, Milwaukee nothing. Swing and a miss. No sign of a go by Johnson there. Let's pause quickly now for station identification.
This is America's number one sports station, WGN, Chicago.
With Steve Stone, Chip Caray back at County Stadium. No balls and a strike to Jose Hernandez, and Lance Johnson is faked back to the first base bag. Wild game in Cincinnati now moves to the eighth. Pirates 6, Reds 6, that game in the 8th. Mets 3, Montreal 2 in the top of the 8th. At Shea Stadium. Atlanta and the Rockies tied at 1 in the 4th. They were snowed out yesterday. So today is the day Don Baylor makes his first appearance back at Coors Field since being replaced as the Rocky manager. He's, of course, the hitting coach with the Braves. Continued whispers in Baltimore that Ray Miller might be in some difficulty there, and perhaps Don Baylor would be the man that would get the summons.
Don Baylor, I thought, did a very good job in Colorado. Obviously, it's going to be difficult to handle your pitching staff where you play arena baseball, but it's exciting baseball in Colorado if you're not a pitcher. And Baylor was there as their first manager for quite some time before being replaced by a man who can really do it. That's Jim Leland. Don Baylor, I'm sure, would like another shot at management.
And I'm sure he'll get one. He did do a good job. Jim Leland, of course, picked up his 1,000th win as a major league manager the other day.
All the other baseball just getting underway or tonight. The Giants will battle the Diamondbacks to surprisingly lead all of Major League Baseball in home runs this year. Jay Bell leads the National League with 5 of them. He's off to a great start. The 0-2 just missed outside for ball one.
Arizona Diamondbacks, after a very difficult start where they kept on squandering some leads late, have clawed their way back. They're 5-6, trying to raise up the ladder in what will be a very tough National League West.
A West that saw the Padres beat Kevin Brown and the Dodgers last night 3-0. Andy Ashby a complete game win. And Jose Hernandez strikes out, and that retires the Cubs in the seventh inning. Seventh inning stretch time here in Milwaukee. Cubs 3, Brewers nothing. Well, it was a quick day for the coach, Mike Ditka, down in New Orleans. One pick and a cloud of dust.
He said he'd give his whole draft if he could get Ricky Williams, and amazingly, the Indianapolis Colts didn't take him. The coach did. He made his one pick, and he said, I'm going golfing.
And he had to sing that he was doing that too, and it was not a pretty sight. Lance Johnson stays in the game. He'll play center field. Jose Hernandez moves from center to short. And Jeremy Burnett leads things off here in the bottom of the seventh inning. Steve Traxel has pitched a magnificent ball game. Just 2 hits in shutting down this high-powered, to this point, Milwaukee offense.
And when was his last shutout?
1996 against the Dodgers. He has 2 of them in his major league career. And he starts off Brenitz with a ball low. 1 ball, no strikes.
Well, you can go a long way toward preserving the opportunity for a shutout, getting through this inning of Brenitz, Berry, and Nielsen. 3 pretty tough hitters right in the middle of this Brewer lineup.
And again, it's just a 3-run game. That one hit a mile high in the air into shallow right center field. Lance Johnson, Sammy Sosa. It'll be Sammy in right. Brenitz is retired for the 3rd straight time. He's 1-for-7 in the series. And he's out number 1 here in the 7th.
What I liked about Steve Traxel today, from the beginning, he changed speeds and he commanded that outside corner to the right-hand hitter. He's got a good curveball, everything working for him. And I believe that over the long haul, that pace that Marty Demerit has tried to encourage by Steve Traxel will serve him well.
Here's Berry. He's 0-for-2. Marty Demerit has to be delighted with the way Traxel has been rocking and rolling here today. Berry went 3-for-4 yesterday, looks for his first hit in this ball game, and that's over for a strike. Marty wants him every, what, 8-9 seconds to make a pitch?
He'd like him to go no longer than 8 seconds, and he has no problem with that. As long as nobody's on, occasionally he will spend a little more time with runners.
Way out in front, 0-2.
But this is vintage Steve Traxel. This is as good as he's looked in quite some time, probably since game number 163 last year.
I was thinking
he was brilliant in that one.
I was thinking the same thing. He has just had command of every pitch from the opening pitch of this ball game. The wind blowing in, the Cubs got him a couple of runs early, and he said, I'm tired of this L stuff. I want to see a W next to my name. He's got a chance for one today. Breaking ball just missed. It's 1-2. Cubs have good news on Kevin Tappany. He played long toss today. Said the arm felt fine. The real test, of course, will come on Monday. He'll throw off a sloped surface off the mound, and we'll see how his arm feels after that experience. Fouled out of play. But all the signs to this point are encouraging. But he said that was when he felt the discomfort was pitching off the mound. We'll see if the rest, the medication, has taken care of that problem for him, and we'll let you know on Tuesday.
Well, as you know, Kevin Tappany is of vital importance to Cub hope. We just have to hope that it's going to be one start, and that's it.
1-2 to Sean Berry. Traxel has retired the last 7 men he's faced. And now Berry backs out. Dave Nielsen, the Milwaukee catcher, waiting on deck. The 1-2 pitch. Struck him out. 5 Traxel strikeouts, and that ball really darted and danced out of the way of Berry and into the glove of Benito Santiago.
Good split finger. It just dove under the bat of Sean Berry. Take a look at the late movement, and that's the key. This one comes up there. It looks like it's just sitting there and darts low and in at the last instant. And it's that late movement that has just mystified the Brewers today.
Eight straight have been retired. The last man to reach was Nilsson, and he bunted to third. And that one rolled foul past Hurst. It's nothing and one.
Pretty good man at first base. You might remember him from his days with the White Sox. And that's Papa Ron Jackson. Very popular man always. And there's a look at Mr. Jackson. A quality guy and a good coach. How about that crowd today?
33,479.
They didn't come for the weather, I know that.
Brewers have drawn 89,000 in their first two games. It'll be an historic year here at County Stadium as folks from Wisconsin and all environs in the general area come to pay their last respects to this grand old ballpark. Same story in Houston, same story in Detroit.
And don't underestimate the drawing power of the Chicago Cubs on the road. Not all that far to get here from Chicago, and you know there's a lot of Cub rooters here. And you take a look around and you see a lot of Cub hats and a lot of Cub blue.
Two balls, one strike. And now Steve falls behind 3-1.
Pretty hard to believe, Chip, that this is the largest second day attendance in Brewer history.
Amazing.
It is amazing.
And I'll tell you what, no matter how cold or windy it is, we got a big break so far this weekend with the weather. That ball hits sharply to second. Morandini has it. Nilsson's retired. Traxel's retired. Nine men in a row. And after seven completed, County Stadium, it's the Cubs still leading Milwaukee 3-0. On to the eighth we go. Cubs 3-0. Steve Traxel has been terrific in his third start of the year. And Cubs fans, be sure to visit the Cubs internet site, www.cubs.com. The site features live audio broadcasts of all Cubs games with the coach, Ron Santo, and Pat Hughes. Daily game notes, fan message boards, online access to Cub tickets and merchandise, player information, and much, much more. The website available 24 hours a day around the world, www.cubs.com. Our email address is cubstv@interaccess.com. We've received several good emails already in the ball game. We still have a couple of innings left. If you have a question for Steve Stone or yours truly, give us a jingle. We'll try to answer it for you. Grace flirts with extra bases and fouls it away and is down two quick strikes.
Well, Mark Grace is hitting just a little over 300, and it's tough to say that he's hitting in tough luck, but the reality of it is he could easily be hitting well over 400. Because I can't remember a stretch where he hit the ball harder for a longer period than the beginning of this season. And there's
that ball's roped down the right field line. That's trouble. It'll rattle off the wall. Burnett has to go in and get it. Grace scampers into second with a leadoff double on an 0-2 pitch.
Mark says, I'm tired of hitting it at people. I'll hit it where nobody can get it. Winds up with a double. And the Cub fans roaring here in Milwaukee as Mark Grace takes a breaking ball 0-2 and drives it down the line.
We'll see how carefully they pitch to Sosa here with first base open, a 3-0 ball game. Sammy is hitless today. He has struck out looking and flied twice to center.
Well, normally behind Sammy, you'd have some protection in Henry Rodriguez, and it would be tough for a right-hander to pitch around him. But the man in the on-deck circle, Glenn Allen Hill, once again 2-for-3 today with a run batted in, and he's got 12 of them. That puts him among the league leaders.
So here's Sosa. Oh, what a cut. Nothing in one. They've resumed hostilities in Arizona. The Giants and the Diamondbacks doing battle. How about that one last night with Charlie Hayes charging Todd Stottlemyre from second base?
Well, occasionally someone charges the mound. Very rarely do you figure it's coming from second base, however.
I would imagine a suspension will be forthcoming.
Yes, and a little bad blood apparently started that one.
And the Diamondbacks have been involved in quite a few scrapes already on the young season.
Well, that's one of the things, and Jim Riggleman was talking about it, one of the things he preaches, Chip, and that's one of the things that Earl Weaver always said. He didn't like his pitchers throwing at anybody, and the reason was he didn't want to see Eddie Murray get hit by the opposition and taken out of contention.
Swing and a miss by Sosa. Good cut. Boy, that's strength against strength. 1-2 now.
Jim Riggleman says the same thing about his pitchers throwing at the opposing hitters because they happen to be red hot at any given time. He said, I don't want Sammy Sosa taking fastballs inside. He's one of the keys to our ball club.
And it's not the hitter's fault that the pitcher can't make a pitch good enough to retire the man, so why take it out on him? One ball, two strikes. Grace leads at second to pitch. High pop out of play. First final in. In the American League, Boston beat Tampa Bay today, 8-5. Sammy yesterday went 4 out of 4. Today he is 0-for-3. And hey, man, wake up. Sosa's up. Somebody's got to tell this guy to.
Little too much tailgating before the game. Well, look, he made it through 7 innings.
1 and 2. Here she comes. He just did get a piece, and he fouled it back. But in that Arizona game, Ellis Burks has hit a home run, I believe. And the Giants lead the Diamondbacks 3-0 in the first. Tony Womack is playing for the Diamondbacks again. And leading off for them.
Well, that team does not have a lot of speed, and although they haven't needed it because they're leading the world in home runs in the early going, eventually they will.
That one skips up there. Nilsson had no chance. And Grace advances to third with nobody out. A wild pitch
and
from
here,
David Weather.
Here you're in an unpleasant situation if you're an infielder for the Brewers, because in a 3-run game you can ill afford to give up another run. So you've got to bring the infield in at all four positions with Sammy Sosa up. And I'm not sure if I'd like that too much. You can see Cirillo. He says, look, I want to play this entire season, so I'll just stay back a step or two at third.
2-2 to Sammy. Low, 3 balls, 2 strikes. Glenn Allen Hill waiting on deck. Yesterday, the Cubs played big baseball, swatting 4 home runs. Today, 4 clutch 2-out singles have plated the 3 runs today. The 3-2. Swung line hard right at center fielder Marquise Grissom. Boy, he hit that ball right on the nose. But he hit it deep enough to score the 4th run of the game, a sacrifice fly. As Mark Grace hits home plate, skids in safely, and that's a big insurance run driven home by Sosa, his 4th RBI of the year. That ball was really tattooed.
Well, it came out like a knuckleball. It was hit so hard, and it looked like it was going to the right of Grissom, and then it came back to his left. Sammy hits a high fastball right on the nose, doesn't get any lift on it, and you see Grissom drifting back, making the play, and Mark Grace goes down for a 3 count.
Just like his namesake, he showed plenty of grace and a big smile on his face as Tom Hallion makes sure he was called safe.
Well, coordination is one of the trademarks of this game.
1 ball, no strikes to Hill. We've already had a few adventures on the year. John Lieber almost knocking himself out, going back into the dugout at Wrigley Field, and now Mark Grace, a little adventure as he touches home plate. That's a big run in this ball game, though. The Cubs now up 4-0. As Hill goes to work and rolls it foul and out of play, 1-2.
Glenn Allen Hill said that last year he changed his stroke. He was always known as a line drive hitter. He is so enormously strong that there was no reason why he couldn't be a consistent home run hitter. He decided to just swing a little bit differently. We've seen the results since putting on a Cub uniform. He's hit a lot of home runs.
And he's hit big home runs in big spots, too. And a great catch by one of the fans over the Milwaukee dugout in the upper deck. Leaning over the rail, that youngster made a clean catch and has a souvenir. Hey, woke up just in time to see the Cubs score the 4th run of the game. The 1-2. Hill smacks that ball one-handed to right. Look how far it travels. Burnett drifts back, puts it away for out number 2. So 2 away, bases empty for Benito Santiago. And a reminder for you, friends, our senior producer, director of Cubs baseball is Arnie Harris. Today's game on WGN is being produced by Pete Toma. Matt Luke is our associate producer, and the executive producer of WGN Sports is Bob Borwell.
Now, I read the paper here in Milwaukee this morning. That guy has been reading that paper since the game started. There's not that much in there. Either a very slow reader,
or the big words are giving him some trouble. 1 ball, no strikes.
2-2 Benito. Oh, high and tight. Santiago's had a fine day today. He's 2 out of 3 with 2 RBIs. And that man was clean shaven when the day began. I didn't know hair could grow that long in cold weather. The 2-0. Right through there. Strike one call. Santiago was 7 runs batted in on the year. He's hitting 188 now. He's picked up 50 points today.
Well, I do believe he is going to hit. And I think he is a very happy man to have come back from that auto accident.
Broken bat roller up the middle. Loretta, good play to his left, takes care of Santiago. And shards of lumber all over the infield. But the Cubs pick up a very important fourth run. A double by Grace, a wild pitch, and a Sosa sacrifice makes it 4-0 heading to the bottom of the eighth. Stoney, here's a look at our Ameritech player that's made a difference. That's the kind of pitching line a former pitcher can appreciate, and certainly the Cubs fans everywhere can appreciate.
Well, Steve Traxel has been in command. You look at those numbers, very impressive on just 81 pitches. So Steve Traxel is indeed our Ameritech player of the game. And Curtis Goodwin checks in left field, on for defense. As the Cubs try to hold a 4-run lead, Traxel's given up 2 lone hits, 1 on a bunt, and 1 other real hard hit ball to left field by, I believe, Mark Loretta.
Jeff Cirillo.
Jeff Cirillo almost out of the ballpark, but the wind knocked it down.
So he's been masterful as he tries to win for the first time this year. He's retired 9 straight men, and he's got the lower third of the order. Loretta, Jenkins, and a pinch hitter here in the eighth.
Once again, Traxel starts him off outside corner for a strike. And that's been the key to this performance.
The pitch count, as you saw, very low for Traxel. I would imagine, Stoney, this is the kind of game, firing in the low 80s, you might consider letting him go the distance.
I don't think there's any doubt about it, especially in a non-save situation.
The 1-1. Is upstairs, 2 balls and a strike.
And really, I think the only way that Jim Riggleman would entertain the idea, if Steve Traxel says he's okay, is if he started walking people. He hasn't shown any indication so far that he's going to do that, however.
He struck out 5, walked 1 today. The 2-1 is fouled back. It's 2-2. Steve's last complete game was last year at Florida. On the 17th of July, the Cubs won that ball game 6-1. So Steve with 7 complete games, bidding for his 8th. He's also bidding for his 3rd major league shutout.
Yeah, we talk a lot about saving the bullpen for Milwaukee, also saving the bullpen for the Cubs. They used 5 pitchers yesterday. So this is a very welcome outing for Jim Riggleman and Marty Demerit.
The 2-2 is bounced towards second. Morandini handles the second hop and takes care of Loretta. 4 out number 1. And with an off day Monday, it allows you the luxury tomorrow of throwing everybody at this Milwaukee team. Everybody can be rested on Monday, and then the Houston team comes to town on Tuesday. So Traxel giving Riggleman exactly what he and the Cubs and himself needed desperately. 10 straight retired by Steve Traxel. And here's Jeff Jenkins.
Kevin Tappany feeling a little better these days. And you know that although everybody says, well, it's not an injury to be concerned with, it's a very much concern to Kevin Tappany and to Jim Riggleman. So hopefully when he throws off the mound on Monday, he's going to feel strong and get over this little bump in the road.
A squibber toward third. Gary Gaetti handles that. Throws across in time to take care of Jenkins. 11 in a row retired now.
And 9 ground ball outs for Steve Traxel, who's not known as a ground ball pitcher. That's how good he's been today, and that's how off balance he's had these Brewer hitters.
So Jenkins retired.
Brian Banks comes on and has a pinch hitter, doing pretty well, hitting 269.
So it's Brian Banks, the Milwaukee final hope in the eighth. We can get 4 more outs and the score stays this way. The Cubs will go for the sweep tomorrow. Our first couple of games back since the infamous Brant Brown ball game last year, and that ball hit a mile high in the air to right. Playable for Sammy. He'll call everybody off and he'll put it away. Traxel has mowed down 12 straight Brewers. He's pitched a terrific ball game. to the ninth we go. Cubs 4, Milwaukee nothing. What kind of hat is that?
That is a wonderful hat, a good headshot, and a wonderfully warm hat, which you could use today at about 35 degrees outside.
How many little critters gave up their beings to provide that guy with a little ear warm? That's a big fur hat.
A quality hat. You know, you live in Orlando, but you live here, you need hats like this. Gloves like that, shoes like that, and everything else.
That would double for a rug in Orlando. It's so big. Here's Mike Myers. He'll be the third pitcher of the day. And he'll face the lower third of the Cub order with Gary Gaetti set to lead things off. Activity in the Cub bullpen. I think that's Matt Karchner out there trying to loosen up on a day that's seen the temperature fluctuate. We saw some sunshine. We've seen some mist, some rain. And now it's just downright cold. Ball game started at 44 degrees. I would be surprised if the thermometer's much past the mid-30s now. Gary today looks for his first hit. And he takes a ball. 1-1. Here's your count as you look at Matt Karchner. Big Cub fan Robert Kelly from Eielson Air Force Base in Alaska watching the game today. He can probably relate to the weather here as Guidy fists that ball toward left. Jenkins comes charging. He's in. He's got it. And there's out number one. Likes the Steve Traxel pacing. We've seen that all day long. He hasn't squeezed the horsehide very much. And that's been most effective for him, as well as having all of his pitches.
And also, Steve Traxel will work quickly without runners on base. And the reality of it is that the Brewers have had three.
That makes it
so when when nobody's on, you don't have to worry too much and you don't have to take your time. And his pace has been terrific.
And Robert also wanted to know about Jeremy Gonzalez. We mentioned that earlier in the broadcast. Jeremy pitched an inning and two thirds in Daytona last night. He was on a pitch count. He threw 32 pitches, an inning and two thirds, gave up just one hit. So certainly good news for Jeremy Gonzalez, whom the Cubs are hoping to have back in the big leagues sometime in mid to late May. And that could be a very big lift for this team. Hideo Nomo was snowed out yesterday. He'll pitch tonight. As the Iowa Cubs entertain Las Vegas, and my wife watching the ball game down in Orlando thinks that man with the big moose hat or whatever that was looks like the dog groomer from the movie Dumb and Dumber.
I didn't see that one, but I'm sure he does. If Susan said she does, then you should agree with her too.
You missed a classic. The pitch. Morandini fists that down the left field line. That's going to dump in there for a base hit. He'll round first. He'll try for second. And there'll be no throw. A stand-up double for Morandini. Doubles number 4 and 5 on the day. Neither one of them have been hit very hard, but they've been hitting the perfect spots.
Pitcher.
And now Traxel hits for himself.
Mickey Morandini has had a great day in the field, and he's picked up a couple of doubles to go with it, as he couldn't have thrown this one out there any better as it slices into the corner. So the dandy little glove man has come through with two more doubles.
I don't think he's going to like you saying that.
Oh, sure he does. Mickey and I are tight.
That's what worries me about Mickey. Here's Steve Traxel. Steve 0 for 3 today. Phil Garner's pitching staff pitched okay today. Not bad, not great. And the Cubs with some clutch two-out hitting today. That's the difference in this ball game early on. They jumped on Roquet for 2 runs in the first. A single run in the third, a single run in the eighth.
Tom Gamboa giving the signs. And that last one, I believe, was get me out of here, I'm freezing.
The 1-0 pitch is on the way. And Traxel nearly skips out of the way. 2 balls, no strikes.
Taking a look at Tom. He looks into the dugout. He gets the signals from the dugout, then gives them to Steve Traxel.
Yeah, he's doing that to try to keep warm, too. If he could do jumping jacks out there, he'd be doing those as well.
He's doing 10 or 12 other signals to stay warm.
2 balls, no strikes. Cubs in front by 4. We're in the top of the ninth.
And Traxel offers at that pitch, I think. Yes, he did, and he missed it. 2-1. Mets have beaten Montreal 3-2. The final at Shea Stadium in New York. How about that Met team? They're playing pretty well without Mike Piazza.
The Mets now 8-4. I think they're going to be there most of this year, right with Atlanta. Philadelphia improved team, playing 500 ball. Obviously, Montreal and Florida are going to have a tough year. But the East looks like a two-horse race. However, Philadelphia has some very good young players.
Traxel got the bunt down, and it's a dandy. Cirillo has one play. It's to first in time. Traxel, a good sacrifice. Four out number two. 5-4 it goes. Morandini to third now with two outs, and Lance Johnson a chance to drive home the Cubs' fifth run.
Last time Steve was unable to do the job, and this time he does it perfectly. With a man at second, you want to move him over. You want that third baseman to field it. And Steve dropped it down very well.
So here is Lance. He reached on a force play. Has a pinch hitter back in the seventh. Runner at third. Two men out. And Lance takes the ball. I want to send along congratulations to Paige and Warren Lockerbie down in Winter Park, Florida. They'll be getting married later on today. So congratulations to the two of them. One ball, no strikes. Swing and a miss. Count evens, 1-1.
Toughest thing with Myers is to try to wait back, because he throws a slow changeup, a little bit of slower changeup, and then he breaks up that with a slow curveball.
He's out of the Doug Jones school of relief pitching. Slow, slower, and slower.
Very much so, but it's effective.
One ball, make that two balls and a strike. You know, you see Jones throw, and not to denigrate his talent, but it looks like he barely throws hard enough to ripple water if he threw it into a pond. But it's all about destroying the hitter's timing, and he does it very well with that assortment of off-speed stuff. The 2-1. Inside, three balls and a strike.
Well, you know that Myers does not want to face a right-hand hitter in this inning, so he'd just as soon end it with Lance Johnson. But at 3-1, you figure he's going to throw a fastball, and Lance should be able to get the good part of the bat on it if it's a strike.
The 3-1 now is a good pitch for a strike on the outside corner, 3-2. Braves and Rockies tied at 2 in the sixth. Tom Glavine looking for his first win of the year for the Braves.
He threw one of the few shutouts ever by a left-hander in that park against that right-hand dominated
lineup.
That
is tough. Giants pounding Arizona 6-1 in the second. As Lance draws the two-out walk, first and third for Jose Hernandez now. And Pittsburgh and the Reds tied at 6 in the bottom of the ninth inning at Synergy Field in Cincinnati.
I think those two teams, when all is said and done this year, will probably be the two teams in the league that you would have to say made the most stride. They got a little bit better in just about every department. Not that they're going to win it, but I think both teams much better than last year.
And I like the move that Jim Bowden made in getting Mark Wohlers. Certainly it is a calculated risk. It could be a very expensive risk, but it's not as expensive as the Atlanta Braves helped it to be. I mean, they paid $5 million for him. It could cost him $800,000 if the Wohlers situation doesn't work out. If it does and he becomes the same guy that throws 100 miles an hour, they'll be glad, I'm sure, to pay the $5.5 million he could earn on his contract in the year 2000.
Well, just try to go out and find what a quality closer costs you these days, especially one who throws the ball like Wohlers when he's right. Now the question is, can a fine pitching coach like Don Gullett turn him around? If he can, could be one of the steals of the last few years.
What do you think will happen with Wohlers? I haven't been able to check the internet to see where they're going to send Wohlers. Would they take Gullett away from the rest of the team to work with Wohlers, or will he travel with the Cincinnati team and work on the side with that ball?
Well, if he refused to go down to the minor leagues for Atlanta, I'm assuming that that's going to be the same situation in Cincinnati. And I think they want Don Gullett with their pitchers in the major leagues. So I think he's going to probably travel with them and see what happens.
A roller foul, one ball, two strikes. Wohlers himself felt that for him to complete his comeback, that a change of scenery, a fresh start, a fresh approach might be what's necessary.
Well, it's not a physical problem, and so obviously he has to get his confidence back. He has to get the belief, Chip, that he can throw the ball consistently over the plate with all of his pitches. And it sounds very easy. In fact, it is a very difficult thing to do when you suffer through the same thing that Steve Blass suffered through. Mike Andrews, an infielder, Steve Sachs at times. Catchers have it also, where they fear throwing the ball back to the pitcher. You might remember Ray Fossey had that problem.
Strike three called on a breaking ball from Myers. That takes care of Jose and the Cubs in the ninth. To the bottom half we go. Milwaukee's down 4-0, and Steve Traxel goes for the complete game shutout. Well, Steve Traxel certainly the star of this game. A two-hit shutout through eight. And he's got to go through the top of the Milwaukee order. Just 93 pitches through eight innings.
And Jim Riggleman essentially said, look, go get him. If you've got this kind of stuff today, there's no reason in the world why you can't complete your own game. And Steve Traxel, who only has two in his entire major league career, knocking at the door for his third. If you can avoid the bullpen, you certainly would like to do that. And Terry Mulholland and Rod Beck throwing in the pen just in case. And the decision for Jim Riggleman after using Terry Mulholland yesterday was to start Brad Woodall tomorrow and make sure that he had Terry available for the next few days. Terry threw the ball very well, as has been his custom lately, and so he will stay in the pen as Brad Woodall will get the nod tomorrow.
And because Steve pitched so well today, assuming he can finish this one off here in the ninth, Riggs will have everybody ready to go for the series finale tomorrow with an off day Monday. So things working out very well for the Cubs, at least to this point. But three more outs to get as Fernando Vina leads things off. Fernando wanted to say hi to all of his family watching the game in Sacramento, California. And we're more than happy to do that. He's a scrappy young player.
Yesterday,
he takes a strike.
Yesterday when they announced the lineups, amid all the trade talks of Fernando Vina, he got the biggest hand of any of the Brewers starters.
Well, he's a Phil Garner-like player, all-out hustle.
Phil just wished that he had this man's speed.
Yeah.
Because I remember Phil, he was a bit of a plow horse, but he was one tough hitter.
The 1-1. He tries to bunt. Traxel snipped it out. Grace Fields has no play. Infield hit Vina. He bunted that ball in a perfect spot.
You got to push it by the pitcher. And then the first baseman has to come get it. So does the second baseman. If you push it by the pitcher, there's really nobody to cover first base. And Vina does it perfectly.
So only the third Milwaukee hit, two of them on bunts today.
I'll tell you, when Ryan Sandberg played here, he was able to coordinate that with both the pitcher and the first baseman. He would cover first base and not go after the ball, trusting that Mark Grace, with his great range, would make the play if the pitcher didn't. And the Cubs got a lot of outs that way that most teams don't, because that's unusual for a second baseman for coverage on that particular play.
So we'll see what Milwaukee does here in the ninth, trailing by four. And Marquise Grissom, the hitter, he's 0 for 3 and looks low at ball one. Traxel has thrown around 95, 96 pitches in this game.
Marquise, after all the leg injuries, does not run as well as he once did. So a ground ball by Traxel, and he's had nine of them so far in this game. A ground ball probably turns into two.
That would be nice as the wind continues to blow and the mercury continues to drop. Grissom swung the ball in his eyes, 1-1. There's the bullpen just in case, but you know Traxel would like to finish it off himself. He looks for his first win of the 1999 campaign.
Yes, but Jim Riggleman is looking up. He's looking up matchups of the guys coming to bat against both Mulholland and Beck, and they have that information right at hand on the bench.
A ball and a strike. Vina, good lead at first. He won't be running, I wouldn't think. Down four, the pitch. Bouncing ball left side. Jose flips to second, one. That's all the Cubs get. Grissom hit it in a good spot, but the ground ball gets the leading runner at second base, and there's one away here in the bottom of the ninth inning.
Jose protected against the elements. Made a good play in the hole, but absolutely no chance to get two. So Traxel now two outs away from his shutout.
Last shutout again, June of 96. Last complete game for Steve, July of 98. And this victory today for him would be his first of the year again, and the fifth in 10 games for the Cubs, and would give us a modest three-game winning streak.
And some pitchers will tell you all I care about is the wins, but you can bet that Steve Praxall wants this shutout.
Yeah, he didn't want to go 0-3 on the year. He came with some extra incentive in this ball game. And he pumps a quick strike over. That's one thing about his game today, Stoney. He's been ahead of a lot of hitters. And for a guy that's normally a fly ball pitcher, he's gotten a lot of ground ball outs today, too.
Well, it comes back to what Marty Demerit was telling him, and that is if you control the outside corner, you can use all of your pitches off that, and that's what he's done today.
No balls and a strike to Cirillo. The Cubs leading 4-0 in the bottom of the ninth inning. Trying to hand Milwaukee its seventh loss of the year. Crowd of 33,000 numbed into silence here in the ninth inning. And Grissom sent scampering back to the bag.
This would be the eighth complete game of Steve Praxall's career and his third shutout if he can accomplish two more outs.
White Sox trailing at Kansas City in the ninth, 5-3, as the 0-1 is laced out of play. Baltimore and Toronto scoreless in the second at Skydome. Yankees in a rain delay in Detroit. It's 1-0 New York. Oakland 4, Texas 1. That game in the second. That game at the Oakland Coliseum. Boston beat Tampa Bay 8-5 today at Fenway Park side of this year's All-Star game. And that will be a very tough, tough ticket, I would imagine.
Yes, I would think so.
0-2, and back to first.
As they find some way to expand that park.
Cleveland 5, Minnesota 1, a final today at Jacobs Field. They don't want people calling it the Jake anymore.
Well, it's surprising that Cleveland will be doing so well. They're 8-1. The next best team is 4-5. That's Kansas City bidding to even their record at 500. It's not going to be a tough divisional race for the Tribe this year, I don't believe.
The 0-2 line drive up the middle, base hit into center field. So first and second, one out, and Jeremy Burnett is the batter. Luckily for the Cubs, it's a four-run lead.
And Riggs already knows the matchups. Mulholland against Burnett and Beck against Burnett, and he's going to come out. I believe he's going to take Steve Praxall out of this game.
Tracks around the 100 pitch mark, and now let's see about that matchup. Rod Beck against Burnett. Burnett's hitting 400. Burnett's against Terry Mulholland. As my frozen fingers flip the pages.
Come on, partner, let's go. Get the information to us.
308, so it's pick your poison here.
Well, the poison is picked. And it's the left-handed half of the duo in the pen, Terry Mulholland.
What a magnificent day for Steve Traxel. A four-hit shutout through eight innings and a third. And the very vocal Cub fans here in Milwaukee give him a standing ovation as he departs leading this ballgame by a score of 4-0. On comes Terry Mulholland to try to help nail it down. 4-0 in the ninth. Back after this. What a game for Steve Traxel, Stoney. He's two outs away from earning his first win of the year. He's a little disappointed, you can tell. He wanted to finish what he started. But he was terrific in command from the opening pitch in subduing this hot-hitting Milwaukee team.
Well, Terry Mulholland has his work cut out for him. Runners at first and second, only one out. And the slugger on this ball club, Jeremy Burnett, looking out at him as Terry Mulholland, who threw an inning in the third yesterday, fanning three of the four men he faced. It was a perfect outing, looking for more of the same here today. And Mulholland on for the fifth time, a scant 1.08 ERA.
Burnett's with a five-game hitting streak on the line now in the ninth inning. Mulholland in a mess, first and second, one man out, the Cubs with a four-run lead. The last thing Terry wants to do is issue any free passes here. If Burnett hits it out of the ballpark, you tip your cap and go after Berry and company with a one-run lead. Let's hope it doesn't come to that. An errorless ball game. Four Milwaukee hits. The 1-0 is fouled away. 102 pitches for Traxel in eight innings and a third, if you keep count.
68 strikes. So he was on top of just about everything. And strike one, the best pitch today for Steve Traxel.
A count of a ball and a strike to Burnett.
He has 4 home runs, 10 RBIs. He has struck out, reached on a force out, and fly to right. He hits that one a mile high right center. On the run, Lance, at the track, at the wall, he leaps up. He keeps it from sailing out. He knocked it down, and now a scramble on the base pass. Morandini runs it back to the infield, and the bases are loaded. Lance Johnson knocked that ball back. Otherwise, it's a 3-run homer.
The longest single we've ever seen. It went 400 feet, just barely staying in the park. What an effort by Lance Johnson. And he held Burnitz at first. Now, nobody was covering first, but Burnitz was standing at second base. Jeremy Burnitz hits this ball a mile, gets a fastball down, and watch Lance. He goes up, times his jump. The ball hits off the glove, hits off the wall, and bounds back in. So the bases are loaded. That'll be it for Terry. And now this is a save situation for the shooter.
Boy, it is it's a game of inches. If he hits that ball 2 more inches, it's out of the park cleanly. If Lance knocks it an inch higher, it's over the wall for a 3-run homer. Instead, it's a 400-foot single, and the base is loaded, and the shooter, Rod Beck, coming on to save the day.
Down 15 for Chicago.
I think Steve Traxel could use a little of that Pepsi AC we were talking about earlier. Now it's a bases-loaded situation and still one out. And on second look, it looks like that ball hit Lance right in the glove.
He goes up high, but it hit the top of the glove, and Lance saw it carry him off the wall, and it loads the bases. I think Burnitz thought he got every bit of it, and he's almost at second base. He was going in his home run trot, and now he realizes that he's got a base runner in front of him. So he heads back to the bag, and fortunately for the Brewers, the man closest to the bag was Ron Jackson. So Rod Beck comes on in search of yet another save, and Beck will be looking for number 3.
Unbelievable. It's never easy in this place, is it?
It doesn't matter what kind of lead you have. The Brewers are tough to beat here.
4-0 ball game, and here's Sean Berry. So Burnitz extends his hitting streak to 6 games. Berry has a 4-game hitting streak on the line. He's 0-for-3 today, and lifetime against Beck, he's had pretty good luck.
He's also grounded into 2 double plays this year. And if the shooter can throw the ground ball, Berry doesn't have great speed.
The Cubs a 4-run lead, 1 out in the bottom of the 9th inning. The pitch is a ball high, 1-0.
Very interested spectator in Steve Traxel. Thinking right now 4-6-3 or 6-4-3 would look awfully good.
1 ball, no strikes. That missed inside. Beck thought he had a strike. It's 2-0. Dave Nelson waiting on deck. The 2-0. Swung line down the left field line. It's off the wall for 2. 1-run score. Streaking around is Cirillo. He will score. It's a double and a 4-2 game. And now we got real problems.
RBI 6 and 7 for Sean Berry. Berry had 3 hits yesterday. This is his first today, and Beck has to come in with a fastball. He's down 2-0. One hops the wall. Good one gets it back in, but not until the lead is cut in half and the game is on the bases in scoring position for the Brewers. And look at Steve Traxel.
So the 2 runners that have scored belong to Traxel. The lead now 4-2, and it's Nilsson against Beck. He's 1-for-3 with a bunt single today. Nilsson on the year with a home run, 4 driven in. The pitch. It's a lefty-righty matchup, and the shooter can't find the zone. 1-0. Nilsson has never faced Beck, and he is a perfect double play candidate. However, it's not a double play situation. Maybe a line into one. He went around that time, 1-1.
Benito Santiago knows that The most critical part of the Beck forkball in this situation is making sure it doesn't get by him, because that scores the run and moves the tying run a sacrifice fly away. So you got to block anything if you call for that split finger fastball.
The hearts are pounding in that Cub dugout now. One ball, one strike. And now time called as Beck begins his motion. That's some dirty pool there by Nilsson. As Beck was ready to go, he got time called by Tom Hallion behind the plate. The Brewers with a ninth inning rally. They've scored twice on four hits. A squibber to the third base side, rolls foul. It's 1-2. That would have scored a run had it stayed fair. So now Nilsson down to his final strike. Still only one out here in the ninth inning. There are about 30,000 cool customers in the ballpark. You hope Rod Beck is the calmest of everybody.
Well, they're going to concede the run on the right side of the infield.
One ball, two strikes to Nilsson. The runners lead at second and third. Swing. Oh, what a cut. He was right on that pitch. And he ripped it foul back to the screen. It stays 1-2.
Well, Nilsson is a good low fastball hitter, and the shooter got that fastball up where you want to get it. You can throw the high fastball by him.
Beck seeking his third high wire act save of the year.
I'm thinking he's going to the forkball. He's going to want to throw it in the dirt.
The 1-2. Off speed, line drive, right side base hit. One run scores. Barry rounds third. Sosa comes up firing. It's not in time. We're tied. Sammy hesitated with that ball in right field. And Beck and Mulholland waste a gem by Steve Traxel.
RBIs 5 and 6 for Dave Nielsen. Now they'll pinch run for him. And you have to believe, Chip, that it's very wet in that outfield. We've had intermittent rain, and I think Sammy never got a grip on this ball. He might have had a shot, but he just can't grip it. And that hesitation cost the run. And Steve Traxel sees the first win go right by the boards.
So Luke Collier comes on to pinch run for Nilsson. He's at first base. He represents the winning run. And now Mark Loretta stands in. The Cubs have blown a four-run lead with one out in the bottom of the ninth inning. And a big cut fouled away. It's 0-1. And on a cold day, who would have thought that we'd be praying for extra innings now? That's the way it stands. Four runs on five hits here in the ninth, and four straight Milwaukee safeties. The 0-1 is high, a ball and a strike. Fernando Vina's single to open up the inning. He was forced out by Grissom. Cirillo single. Burnett's almost hit a three-run homer. He single. Barry doubled home two. Nilsson singles home two to right. We're tied at four with the winning run at first. And that's fouled out of play, 1-2. Mark Loretta is 0-3. Brewers didn't do any hitting early, but they've done it late. They were held to two hits through eight. They've got five hits here in the ninth.
Well, at least for the moment, they are the big possum. They didn't walk late, they hit late.
Man, oh man. A sickening turn of events for the Cubs. One ball, two strikes. Again, Loretta making Beck work here. A fan sitting outside in the elements fighting for that foul ball nearly came tumbling out of the crow's nest.
Would have made it a bad day. He came an eyelash from going over the side.
A ball, two strikes. They play Loretta straight away. The pitch, the runner goes, swung on, hit high in the air into straightaway center. Lance drifting back, still going back, now slowing down. There's out number two. Collier heads back to first. Looking ahead to what we hope we'll see the 10th inning, the Cubs will have Grace, Sosa, and Goodwin do. And here's Jeff Jenkins. Jenkins 0 for 1 against Beck Lifetime.
Jenkins does have tremendous power. And now we'll see what Garner wants to do with Lou Collier. He was running on the pitch before this. Let's see if he's going here.
Big lead, not going. Pitch swing and a miss, 0-1. Let's pause quickly for station identification.
This is America's number one sports station, WGN, Chicago.
Steve Stone, Chip Caray back at County Stadium. A four-run Milwaukee bottom of the ninth. The pitch. Swung line left center field. Goodwin on the run. Can't get there. It's off the wall. Collier on second. He's on his way to third. He's going to score. And the Brewers score five in the ninth and sink the Cubs in heartbreaking fashion 5-4.
That's pretty hard to believe, but unfortunately, Goodwin was playing very shallow. And where a double can beat you, you got to play a little deeper than that. That ball just split perfectly between Goodwin and Lance Johnson. And a very excited Milwaukee Brewer ball club, a very dejected Cub ball club, saw it get away in the ninth, Chip. And this Brewer team never quits. You have to hand it to them.
We saw it last year. And today they rip the hearts out of our chests and stomp on them here at County Stadium. Five runs in the ninth after Steve Traxel was cruising along. Terry Mulholland and Rod Beck could get only one out. Six hits in the inning, and the Cubs, frankly, blew this ball game in Milwaukee. A chance to even the record at 5-5 escapes us in the ninth. Milwaukee wins it 5-4. Mike Myers the winner, Rod Beck the loser, and a heartbreaking loss. Oh boy, we'll be back to talk about it in a moment. Well, folks, this one really hurts. Milwaukee was being shut out on two hits through eight innings. They score five runs on six hits in the bottom of the ninth inning and beat the Cubs 5-4 today. Mike Myers gets the lucky win. Rod Beck didn't have much. He takes his first loss of the year. The Brewers with a huge uprising do it to us again in the late innings. We've seen that before. And the bright spot for the Cubs, clutch two-out hitting, but they couldn't get three outs in the ninth inning. Our Budweiser play of the game, the RBI double by Jeff Jenkins. It scored Lou Collier with the winning run. And the Milwaukee Brewers even up this series at a game apiece, beating the Cubs 5-4. Chance for redemption tomorrow. 1 o'clock our airtime for the third final and rubber game of the series. Brad Woodall against Steve Woodard. We'll have it for you here on WGN beginning at 1 o'clock. So for Steve Stone, Arnie Harris, and the commander, Pete Toma, this is Chip Caray. Boy, this one hurts, folks. But hopefully better times tomorrow. We'll see you then. Stay tuned for the 10th inning show. It's coming up next. Final score once again, Milwaukee 5, Cubs 4.
Chicago Cubs baseball on WGN was brought to you by Brewery Fresh Budweiser, who reminds you fresh beer tastes better. Your friendly Chicago area Dodge dealer, the new Dodge, test drive the future. Ameritech, in a world of technology, people make the difference. Pepsi, the joy of cola. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. And by Southwest Airlines, offering low fares and frequent flights. Southwest Airlines, the official airline of the Chicago Cubs.